Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, the prosecution is not going to get that man today. No, because I'm going to get him.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Hagmann and Hagmann Report on this Friday, July 25th, 2014. I'm your co-host, Joe Hagmann, along with my father, my co-host, Doug Hagmann. We are private investigators who host a radio show on current events from a biblical perspective. Tonight, we got a great show lined up for you tonight. We're going to be joined by Dave Hodges as soon as I call him, and I am dialing the number now. So he has a lot of information to share on certain topics that are in the news and things that we're not hearing about that should be in the news, as they are just as important and dangerous to this country as any scandal we see happening today. My dad is Skype is kicking us off, not letting us connect the way we usually do, so we actually were having
Dave Hodges.
Dave, Joe Hagmann here.
Hi, Joe Hagmann there. How you doing?
Oh, we're fighting with our radio server here to try to be able to host the show. We didn't actually connect till after the show started, so it kept kicking us off. But we're here and we're live in my dad's.
And I'm here, I believe.
Hello, Doug.
There was almost an intentional weapons discharge in the studio at one of the at one of the boards here. So, at any rate, Dave, yeah. Welcome to the program. I just want to remind folks that this is a live broadcast. It is Friday, July 25th, 2014. And for new listeners, and thanks for checking in with us. We've got a lot of emails over the last couple of days. Our broadcasts extend from 8 to 11 p.m. Eastern Time. Of course, our home base, HomelandSecurityUS.com. Folks, if you go to HomelandSecurityUS.com, on the right-hand side, we have now included, you can't miss it, it's like really huge over there. We've now included what it looks to be like a smartphone along with our app. So you've got, if you click on the two boxes right below the phone, you will find the App Store, available on the iPhone App Store. That's our app, as well as available on Google Play. So, interesting stuff new to this technology. Dave, welcome again. As Joe said, welcome. And
his website, The Common Sense Show.
That's right.
.com. If you don't have this bookmark it, as Dave writes fantastic articles and the content is the top of the line. And most importantly, tonight we're going to be talking about the article, which is at the very top of the site, All Signs Point to a Coming EMP Attack Upon the United States. And with that,
Wait, Dave, hold that thought. Joe, you've got a correction, I believe, to make some housekeeping before we go on. Is that right?
Thanks.
So go ahead and take care of that first. Sorry, Dave. Hang on a second. We're going to preempt Dave Hodges for a correction.
Yeah. Last night we had W on, and he was sharing the numerology aspect of different things, and he stated that the temples of Jerusalem were both destroyed on the 17th of Tammuz. And I want to thank Lynn for emailing and stating correctly that he was not correct. It was the 9th of Av, and just talked to him before the show, and Lynn, W said thanks for sending this information. He did turn those two around, and he was stated it incorrectly. So it was the 9th of Av, not the 17th of Tammuz, when both temples were destroyed. And he wanted me to make sure I said that on air and thanked you. So
I'm just trying to think of any other way we can interrupt Dave Hodges one more time. But let's just bring him on.
I get
Dave.
These conversations at home.
I know what you mean. I do know. So
my wife always has the last word. as it
and
should be.
And the first one, right? Well,
yeah. Well, yeah, the first and the last, and I get to squeeze in a thought, and that's how it should be. She's the brains of the family.
Well, what's up, my friend? We got a lot to talk about. Apparently, I got so many emails about you here over the last couple of days, your information. What's going on?
Well, you know, I've been really working on the border thing and the UN vehicles and the pandemics coming in. And, you know, and I thought, okay, where is this all going to lead? Because the UN is already at the border. In fact, maybe I should start here. I had a chance encounter with a Border Patrol officer. We went on vacation. I went into a convenience store, and I only had about a 90-second, excuse me, I'm a little under the weather, so you have to forgive me. I only had a real short conversation with this man. I handed him my business card that had my radio show information on it, and I said, I promise I won't use your name. I'm just trying to clear up a few things, and some of your guys have been in contact with someone who I know, Dr. Jane Orient, who's one of our top physicians here in Arizona, and they've been telling her that the Border Patrol is coming down with scabies, drug-resistant TB, bacteriological pneumonia, and it's all being covered up. They're doing on-site laundry so they don't carry this stuff home to their families. They're now being infected with scabies, which could be carriers for more serious things like dengue disease and stuff like that. And Dr. Orient was told something that I was told by this Border Patrol agent. He said, do you know about the 100,000 West Africans? And I said, yes. And he said, do you know they're taught to speak Spanish so they'll blend in before they come here? He goes, they admitted that to us. And I said, yes. And I said, that's a CIA operation. And he said, do you know where they're from? And I said, yes, the seven-state region in West Africa where there's a live, uncontained, uncontrollable outbreak of Ebola. And on my show, Dr. Orient, who's very conservative by nature, came out and said it's not a matter of if, but when and where we have an Ebola outbreak in this country. So I've been working really hard on that. And this Border Patrol agent called me after he had read some articles I had written, and he said, there's more that you need to know. And I think he began to trust me because I never printed his name, and I could clearly see his badge. And this is just a chance encounter, Doug. We were traveling to San Diego on vacation. We stopped in Yuma, Arizona to gas and go to the bathroom and get a drink, and there he was. And I just thought, well, I'm going to take advantage of this. And so he calls me back, and he has a friend with him, and he tells me that the UN already has a presence on the border. And I said, how do you know? And he said, well, they've taken 75% of us off live border patrol duty, like we do drug busts and this and that. And he said, now we're doing clerical work where we're pretending to process these immigrants. And he said, only 10% of them are as advertised in the media, 10% unaccompanied minors. He said, the rest are adults or the children are with some kind of guardian or parent. He said, that's a lie you're being told. But he said, I have to sign in to the detention centers when we go in to procure these people and then take them to an interview room. And he said, he has seen the sign-in list. It's electronic. But he says, when I go to sign in, I can see, you know, the top 10 names that have signed in above me. And people from the World Health Organization, DHS, as you would imagine, but also the United Nations and various departments of the United Nations are signing in at these Border Patrol controlled areas in the detention centers. And so my articles I've been writing about DHS is going to roll out the UN when there's a pandemic, and that'll be the foothold for the UN to gain a presence in this country that'll be acceptable. But I said there has to be beyond that for the UN to move into the legitimate peacekeeping force that they're going to claim that they are, with the Russian and Chinese soldiers wearing blue helmets coming to get our guns. And you know, in New York, they ran an ad about 3 weeks ago for basically gun confiscation experts, and it's right out of their UN New York office. And before they do that, I said, they have to have a false flag. And I've been racking my brain thinking about, okay, what could this false flag possibly be? And then I hearken back to a map that I've been in possession of. In fact, I'm in possession of the entire set of documents. I have a set of documents that was given to me by a retired member of the Department of Agriculture. And she came into possession of it because she was concerned that the massive war games that the U.S. Navy and Air Force were planning off every one of our coastline, including most of our territories, would be detrimental to crop yield. And so she tried to draw attention unsuccessfully. And to the best of my knowledge right now, guys, I'm the only one in the country that has the map, and it's on the article right at the top, that shows this massive war game. Now, that map comes from an organization called AFAST, which is the sonar aspect of the Navy. And what they're doing, all those rectangles on the map, and if people want to look at it, they go to commonsenseshow.com and look right on there, and you'll see the map pull right up. You'll see oblong rectangles and squares and stuff. And it basically incorporates almost every aspect of the coastline of the three United coastlines, except for the Gulf. There's some areas in there in the Gulf that are barren, and I think largely because those areas are destroyed from the Gulf oil explosion, or they could be being left purposely open. So this, in 2009, the Navy announced their intention to do a five-year war game. No one does a five-year war game. No one. No one usually does a 30-day war game. And this is a five-year war game, and I have letters, and one of them is published in the article down in the bottom in the area I titled Appendix, that's written by some of the congressional members of California, Oregon, and Washington. And in fact, later, this was joined onto by Dianne Feinstein and Barbara Boxer and Henry Waxman. They added their names on at a later time. They wrote to the Undersecretary of the National Oceanographic Administration and asked him to stop the Navy from doing these war games because of all the mammals they would destroy with the sonar and the missiles and the drills and all this stuff. And NOAA turned them down. So they took their plea directly to the Secretary of the Navy, B.J. Penn, and this is back in, I think, April of 2009. And Penn just dismissed them, said, "You're not going to tell us how to conduct our business," and told them to go away. Now, you would think that if the congressional delegations of Oregon, California, and Washington would come out and say, "You can't do these war games because they're going to destroy our coastline, they're going to destroy millions of mammal life, and this sonar is unwarranted, it's going to harm everything in the area," you got to stop. You think this would make major media. You think this would be all over Fox. It would, but no. I mainstream researched this. It's not there, but I have all the documents. And people can satisfy themselves that I put some of those documents in this article this morning. Here's what it means, Doug, and this is where I think we can cut right to the chase here. The question I asked sarcastically and rhetorically in my article, are the ships facing the coastline or are they facing out? Because yesterday I put the map in my article and I asked people, tell me what this war games are doing here for 5 years. And most people wrote in and said they're going to try to keep us from escaping when martial law comes. That was the most consistent guess. And I think that's logical looking at the map, but it's not right. They're using sonar. What do you look for when you use sonar? You look for submarines.
Big fish.
Big fish. Big fish that fire big fish.
That's right.
And if you want to take down the grid, and I don't think the entire grid's coming down. That's another aspect I'm actually writing about in tomorrow's article. The Chinese have weapons, EMP weapons, that they can take out localities. They can take out a section, a region, a state, or three-state area, but they don't want to take over a nation that's entire grid system is down permanently. And we're talking, if you took a grid down in the most common way that people think of it, you're going to see a situation where you're not going to have much to inherit, 90% fatalities according to the Naval War College after 2 years. My Congressman Trent Franks, has been beating this bandwagon to harden our power supplies and our power grid, you know, against an EMP attack, and no one's listening to him. I think he's being very responsible. I'm not a big fan of his, but in this area, he's right. But these ships are out there looking for an EMP attacker, and there's no question in my mind that's what they're doing. And I saw some hard proof of this, too. When we were in San Diego on the vacation I mentioned, we toured the Midway, you know, that's in mothballs now, it's turned into a museum. And across the bay, you should be able to see all the ships there in San Diego Harbor that are Navy ships. The only ship they had was a tugboat. We went over and ate lunch on the other side of the bay where you could really see the ships up close, tugboat. Now, before we were done with our meal, a destroyer came into port. But I'm hearing these reports that a lot of these ships are now out to sea on a rotating basis. This is an ongoing war game. I got the congressional letters and the documents and the map that show it. And yet, this is going nowhere. Now, why are they looking for an EMP attack? Well, I think the military is afraid they're going to be destroyed before the UN takeover. I think the UN is waiting to roll out their troops until they do an EMP that would cripple the military who might stand up and oppose their takeover. The prime directive of any institution, military, education, medicine, is to survive, stay intact, operate. And this is why I think we're seeing a lot of our ships and our Air Force and some Marine contingent involved in these drills. And I think they're opposing what's going on. Now, you know, I've said this on the show. I've had my military insider sources said that there would have already been a major coup against this administration if they had the popular support of the people, but the majority of the people are too dumbed down. So in the article today, I said the military is not on the same side as the administration. And I went back and I recounted what I had reported a long time ago about how Admiral Guyette and General Ham, the commander of AFRICOM, Guyette, the commander of Carrier Task Force 3, two of the top four commanders in the Middle East, committed mutiny against Barack Obama by trying to rescue Ambassador Stevens. And the reason, and Jim Garrow said this to me, I've had other people in my confidential source arena tell me this, they were going to try to save Garrow, or not Garrow, excuse me, they're going to try to save Stevens because he would have sung about drug running, gun running, child sex trafficking, all to raise money to support regime change, giving it to Al-Qaeda, Muslim Brotherhood, and regime change in Libya and then in Syria. And that would have brought down this administration, which is what the military wants. But the number twos in the command of each officer arrested them. And in General Ham's case, it was a Colonel Rodriguez of the CIA. And Obama has done a lot of this, and I'm sure you've heard this, that in a lot of the major commands, Obama is embedding CIA people as the executive officer to keep a watch on the commanders.
Wait a second, Dave. How does that work? Okay, because
okay, if you're let's say you're a colonel, okay, and
right.
Your name is Colonel Rodriguez, and you've been working for the CIA, you just get conveniently transferred over to General Ham's command, and he's told this is your XO.
Well, wait a second, though. Isn't, for example, a CIA, you've got CIA case officers, then you've got CIA agents, then you've got CIA operatives, and then, of course, different classifications of different positions within the CIA. Now, having said that, don't you have to be a military officer?
Yes. Yeah, the man who arrested Ham and stopped and aborted the attempted rescue of Ambassador Stevens and his bodyguard contingent is a colonel. And
okay.
He assumed command of AFRICOM temporarily after that. And I do not have the name of the man who arrested Guyette. My source would not give it to me. Guyette was taken. I do know where they took him. They took him to Bremerton, Washington, at the base there. They held him under house arrest, and they said if he said anything, he'd disappear in the NDA, and no one would ever hear from him again. They'd just say he had a heart attack and bury him. That's what he told one of his sources, and it got back to my source. They allowed him to leave the military on pretty favorable terms, but I want you to hear the excuse. This was actually reported in ABC about Guyette's departure. They said he left because inappropriate comments and actions towards minority members in his command. In other words, here's a guy who's worked his way to the top of being a carrier task force commander, and he doesn't know how to talk to African Americans, Latinos, people of Muslim background in his command. Are you kidding me? You get to that level and you can't deal with a multiracial military force?
Yeah, that doesn't sound right, obviously. Yeah.
No, So, here's the other thing I wrote in the article today. These two men didn't decide unilaterally and arbitrarily to disobey a presidential directive delivered to them by Leon Panetta. They didn't do that. They had help from the outside. For them to launch a rescue mission, they had to have someone redirect satellites, make sure the traffic corridors were open, get traffic reports, get troop logistics reports in the area. They had to know what their troops were walking into. This was a coordinated effort for a military coup in the Middle East, just in the Middle East, not in Washington, not to arrest Obama, but just in the Middle East. Well, that coup failed. You know, Ham's career blew up, and Guyette's out of the Navy, and unfortunately, it failed. And I'm sure if Stevens was rescued from that, he would have known he was set up, because we know how many times he asked Hillary Clinton to increase his bodyguard patrol. Now, when you move forward from this event, you've got other situations to point to the fact that I'm right. Last November 13th and 14th, you had a drill called the Grid X drill. And that was a drill where you had a simulated takedown of the power grid and how FEMA, DHS, and other agencies would respond to the crisis. What's interesting to me is they invited the Chinese and the Russians to participate. I almost couldn't believe my eyes when I read the NERC report on this, as they said, oh yeah, our Russian and Chinese allies will be here. Are you kidding me? These are the same Russians and Chinese that were threatening to nuke us over Syria in the same time frame. Stay out of Iran or it'll mean nuclear war. Both countries delivered multiple threats, yet we invite them into a highly secure drill and basically gave them the keys to the car on how to take down our grid. Okay, if that's not enough for you, Doug, today I published a document. It's called a bilateral agreement between FEMA and the Russian Ministry of Defense that permitted 15,000 Russian soldiers to come into the country to train for emergency situations, martial law. Okay, so that's there.
Okay.
And then you and I know, and Steve Quayle, we all have the reports of the Russian soldiers in various communities and so forth and so on. I mean, this is no secret. We've talked about this many times. These are your enforcement troops. They're here to seal the deal when all heck breaks loose. And then you have the Chinese side of it. The solar energy zones, to me, the discovery of what those were and the fact that they're over land that has massive mineral resources underneath of it is the most significant thing that came out of the Clavin Bundy affair. And we know on his ranch,
Bingo.
The Chinese were going to have a solar energy zone owned by ENN, which is a military corporation out of China. And this is a way they can bring in their soldiers. And the Chinese are being handed a lot of our solar energy projects. In fact, an article I wrote about Bundy affair back in April, I did a side-by-side analysis of the project in Arizona and the project in Nevada. And they're all the same, and the Chinese are at the heart of all of it. And this is a good way to bring in your troops in ostensibly what would be called an inland port. So the Russians and Chinese troops are here. The UN is positioned. We have massive immigration, a total open border, and possible pandemics that could put the country in absolute chaos. And I think the coup de grace is going to be an EMP attack. And I think the reason the military, a lot of the military, is offshore with regard to these military war drills is because they feel they'll survive an EMP attack. If they're on top of a submarine or a cargo ship that launches, if they're in that same area, they're not going to be affected because a submarine, say from China, Russia, or North Korea, who also has EMP weapons, they're not going to commit suicide. So I think this is why these war games exist.
David, I don't mean to interrupt you. Wouldn't our military assets be hardened against an EMP attack well beyond what our normal infrastructure would be?
Most of your ships aren't. Your nuclear silos are. Their supporting power grid system is. But most of your military hard military assets, your tanks, your jeeps, most of your ships, most of your planes are not.
Okay. All
right. We're vulnerable. This is what Trent Franks is talking about. He said our infrastructure across all borders, in other words, I'm sure he's speaking about military, scientific, power industry, is all unprotected. In fact, let's jump to Yemen for a second. Yemen is an area where I think we just saw a false flag attack, and I think it was a beta test.
Yeah, you were saying that before. I didn't mean to interrupt, but you were saying about Yemen before, and not too many people really understand what the heck happened there.
Well, in Yemen, there was they say it was Al Qaeda that did it, but I haven't seen any proof that Al Qaeda took down the power grid of Yemen. in one day. A country of 23 million people, and the power grid is totally wiped out in one day. It's just gone. And I got a picture of one of the collapsed power grids, and I'm laughing because I can't believe that people aren't on top of this stuff. In fact, but some people are. And if you'll give me just a minute here, I want to change directions here for a second, and I want to pull up my Yemen material here. And folks,
we're talking to Dave Hodges. Folks, you can tune him in every Sunday night, but information about his program. But his website, is on his website, which is thecommonsenseshow.com. That's thecommonsenseshow.com. And there, if you go to his website, you can see the articles that he's talking about, including the map. And while you're doing that, Dave, where did you get that map from again?
I got it from a recently retired employee, and she had an administrative position with the Department of Agriculture.
Ah, okay. All right.
And she jumped on the same environmental bandwagon that Waxman and Boxer and these other politicians did about why they wanted these war games stopped.
I get it now.
And so that's how it came to my attention. And it's been sitting here in my mind, Doug and Joe, it's been here in my mind for 2 years. Okay, this war drill, it's unprecedented. It's a huge waste of money. Why are we doing this? I don't get it. And I've gone through a million scenarios in my mind. But it wasn't until this border situation began to unfold, and I'm seeing the possibilities of us totally losing our control of our country to the UN, predicated on a false flag. And I was just laying in bed one morning, getting ready to get out of bed, and it hit me. I said, the military is protecting itself. That's why they're not in country. I mean, think about the Army, our combat forces, 165,000 troops in Afghanistan. That's the bulk of our land fighting force. And then you've got these ships out to sea. The military is in self-protection mode. Anyway, I've got this information here on Yemen here I just pulled up. I wanted to make sure I got the names right.
Okay.
There are public references to an ex-CIA intelligence officer named Dr. Peter Pry, P-R-Y, and I link into the mainstream accounts of what he said. And what he basically said is what happened to Yemen can happen to the U.S. Pretty cryptic warning. And then I said, but if you think he's CIA and you can't believe anything the CIA says, just remember Operation Northwoods, because the analogy fits. But here's a more even telling quote. In the Wall Street Journal, and in my article I have the link to it, FERC Chairman John Wellinghoff stated that a similar attack on Yemen, and this is a quote, destroyed nine infrastructure substations, okay, power stations, and transformer manufacturer, the entire United States grid would go down for at least 18 months or probably longer. And he's saying you have to take down nine of them. Now, we've promised the Chinese the hard assets of this country. The Pioneer Institute did an audit of untapped mineral resources estimated to be underneath the earth in the United States, and they came up with a figure of between $128 and $150 trillion worth of assets. This is why you're seeing the solar energy zones going over these mineral-rich resources. And the inland ports that the Chinese are being allowed to inhabit are in mineral-rich area resources. They don't want to inherit a pile of junk. So I don't think we're going to see a total power grid takedown like we did in that NBC TV show called Revolution, where everything was gone. I don't think we're going to see that. I think we're going to see surgical precision takedowns, and you'll see high altitude detonated nuclear blasts to do it in a particular area. And you can contain the scope of your EMP attack, and you can actually cause the whole grid to go down for a while, but you can bring back up most of it if you haven't destroyed all the component parts. And I think this is exactly what we're going to see, because the Chinese don't want to inherit nothing. And they wouldn't be on board with this kind of plan. And I think this is what we're seeing. I think the military knows about it, and I think this is why they have their ships positioned where they do, so they're going to be largely unaffected by it.
Okay.
Now, the question is, are they going to fight on behalf of the people? I don't know. And when I talk to my sources, I don't get real clear answers on that point. And I've expressed frustration to them on that point too, Doug. I've told them, I said, well, come on, whose side are these guys going to be on? When the shooting starts and they're opposing the UN, are they here to defend me, to stay in my home against the Chinese or the Russians taking me to a FEMA camp? So that's food for thought. Speaking of FEMA camps, I have an interesting aside. I think you'll find this interesting. In yesterday's article, I wrote an article that said there's one FEMA camp for the immigrants and one for us. I went back to 2011, and I found a Bob Seifert. He's an administrator for KBR, Kellogg, Briand, and Root. And they're the ones in conjunction with Halliburton that had a lot of the construction contracts on the early FEMA camps. He had put out an emergency memo for vendors that could provide wiring for a temporary camp that would house either 2,000 or 300 or 60 people. And he said, and you need to have water, showers, meals ready to eat, this kind of stuff. And this memo went out, and it was in 2011. Okay, this is not your classic FEMA camp construction stuff. And I said this when the memo leaked in 2011. Well, when I was in San Diego on vacation, this was a huge topic because a lot of the illegal aliens were being flown into Lindbergh Field. And someone had come in at Lindbergh Field and constructed the temporary FEMA camp housing that matched identically to the specifications on this KBR leaked memo. And I have that in yesterday's article. That's a temporary way station. And what I've been told by the Border Patrol, they bring these people in, they stay 72 to 96 hours, and then they bus them or fly them out to locations all across the country, and then they bring in the next wave of immigrants. And this is being done in places like Lindbergh Field. That was planned for in 2011, Doug. In other words, this immigration crisis was planned for 3 years ago.
Oh, yeah. We have that same information, Dave. I mean, our sources have confirmed the same as you've reported, the fact that this has been in the works for quite some time. And of course, we also have to consider what Russia has been doing in Central America in terms of arming the different cartels and kind of the same thing our CIA has been doing in a lot of ways.
I've got information on that.
All right.
This has been the month of let's let confidential sources approach Dave Hodges. I've had two. And you know how rare that is to get two that close together.
Yeah.
Now, one of them I kind of created through a chance encounter, and the guy trusted me when I didn't use his name in an article, and then he started giving me more on the phone. But this other guy is a DEA special agent, and he's active. He's still in the service. And his GS ranking is fairly high, but I don't want to narrow it down more than that because I don't want to make him an easier target to find. Although I think, and I told him this, he's already said enough that if they wanted to find him, they know who he is.
Okay, just to be clear to our the listening audience, when you say anonymous sources, they're known to you, period. They're not, and they're known to you, and they're confirmed by you, right?
Yes.
Okay, and folks, that's important for everyone to understand, because Dave often gets misquoted. I get misquoted when we talk about anonymous sources. We talk about people that we know personally, who are known and trusted to us, but we choose not to name them. And sometimes people think, well, you don't know who they are. No, we do know who they are. So go ahead, sir.
Well, this man approached me, and he actually approached me through a very unusual method. Now, we don't communicate this way anymore. In fact, I'm kind of nervous because I haven't actually heard from him in 3 days, and that's been unusual. He was vacationing in the about 60, 70 miles from where I live. And I don't know if that's why, well, he told me why he singled me out. He said, you understand what's going on with money laundering. And this ties back into your comment about the Russians and the cartels. And he was stationed in Peru. And there's a cartel down there that very few people have ever heard of. And they're called the Sanchez Paredes cartel.
Right.
They're the largest growers and distributors of cocaine in the world. They've taken that over from Colombia, and it's a Peruvian military organization. It's totally state-sponsored, and we are in support of it through the DEA. Let me just give you a couple tidbits he gave me. He was this will give away who he is, but he told me there's no restrictions on revealing his Peruvian activities. He said that he was the third operative to be removed from his position for going after this cartel. The two before him were publishing reports critical of our surveillance habits, said we weren't, as DEA, doing due diligence. The Sanchez Paredes cartel is the biggest cartel in the world. They have ties to Hamas, Hezbollah, and the Muslim Brotherhood. And we all know that the arms procurer agent and the head of finance for the Muslim Brotherhood is the half-brother of President Obama. His name is Malik Obama. They're all connected. So you have the Sanchez Paredes that are connected out of the Middle East. They procure weapons, and that'll become important in this story that we're talking about. They procure weapons. Now, some of the weapons, I've been told, have, as you say, Russian origin. But what I was told is they're not being delivered by the Russians, or if they are, they're being delivered by the Russian mafia that's moving into Peru to open up their Russian casinos and their sex trafficking organizations.
Right. And by the way, Dave and ladies and gentlemen, this particular cartel, you can certainly look this up for yourself, but Manhattan, in fact, their U.S. Attorney General, they seized whatever $30 million worth of international drug trafficking money back. I'm going back now 3-4 years, sometime in maybe it's 2012, 2013. I don't know if you recall that, but that was very active in Manhattan. So they're all over the United States.
Well, yeah, I'm going to get into that a little bit too, if that's okay.
Oh, please.
I think what people need to know is by the end of the evening, you're going to realize that your entire financial structure in the United States is based on money laundering. In fact, I'll jump to one part of the end of the story here to kind of set the tone. I've been working with a researcher named Elena Cook, who's a former defense contractor, and she had a security clearance, and she's also recently written for WorldNet Daily until she decided to go independent. Elena came across reports that said during the 2008 and 2009 bailouts, had it not been for money laundering coming out of the drug cartels, there would have been absolutely no cash liquidity in this country at all, and the economy would have ground to an absolute stop. Nothing would have moved, and we would have had total chaos at that point. So actually, I'm not in favor of money laundering, of course, but that actually saved us at one time. But I find that to be really interesting. But anyway, I'm going to pull up this man's first contact with me right here. And he really had a lot to say on his first contact with me. Let me just read to you just his couple opening statements here. Dear Mr. Hodges, thank you for your courageous work. I am a DEA special agent. I can provide proof. He did provide the proof. And he got into investigating money laundering, specifically of the Sanchez Paredes cartel, via their confidential sources. Now, they have their own version of the boogeyman terrorists over there in Venezuela called the Sendero Luminoso. They go out and do these terrorist acts to take heat off the Sanchez Paredes cartel. I thought that was really interesting, that they actually have an organization designed to draw attention to them to take it off the Sanchez Paredes cartel. Now, here's what I learned from him. But I also had it confirmed in other sources. I had this information about what I'm really telling you before he told me. He just confirmed it in a way that I did not know. Outside San Salvador, and this is why I'm concerned about the illegal immigrants coming into the country, you have MS-13, Los Zetos cartel, and the Sinaloa cartel training. And they're training with Hamas. And I have documented this in an earlier article this month where Hamas is supplying weapons through the Sanchez Paredes cartel. It goes to the Sinaloas to control, and they do the training. MS-13 are now the assassin agency for these Mexican drug cartels, but they're no longer just drug cartels. They need to be considered to be military operations. They have anti-tank weapons and all the automatic weapons you'd have, and I've been told they have helicopters. And if you recall, we've had helicopters on two occasions cross the border and attack the Border Patrol.
Right.
Yeah, and also, this is something that all Americans need to be concerned about as well. What I learned from my source is that the American military is training the Peruvian military, and they've stepped up their training. Now, what could they be training them? And these are narco terrorists. Are they training them how to protect their drug shipments better? I suspect so, because what we also know is the military of our country is doing the same thing in Mexico. We're training the Mexican military. Now, if you want to have a chance to have a Mexican military official who's not co-opted by the Sinaloas, you go to the Navy and the Marines. They're not located in one area long enough to be co-opted, is what I've been told, on large numbers. But the Mexican military is overrun with a drug cartel influence. So, in effect, our military is training narco-terrorists with the Peruvian army that's running these drug and gun shipments, and we're also training the Mexican military, and I say ostensibly for the same thing, in a fast and furious kind of approach. Now, they're now sending in MS-13 by the tens of thousands into this country. What I was told by this Border Patrol agent, he said, we've cataloged 10,000 that we think are. He said, but we're told when we file the official report, you leave off the MS-13 and treat them like anything else. Even when they admit to murdering and torturing and all that, he said, we're not allowed to use it by order of DHS. So we have these MS-13 people coming into the country and being scattered far and wide. But here's a really ominous sign that this Border Patrol agent told me. He said, you'll be in a detention center. Let's say it's 50 by 50. And he said, you know you have three MS-13 guys, but you have a hold on their account. In other words, you can't move them until the hold is removed on the computer. But he said, when three of them become like eight or ten of them, then all of a sudden the hold's released, and we release them to the same geographic locations. So in effect, we are releasing MS-13 death squads throughout the country. In fact, I have Roger Brown on, a real prominent sociologist who's going to talk about some of this on my show Sunday night in the last hour. This is very disturbing. This says this to me, Doug, that what we're looking at in Mexico is if you want a police chief killed, a city councilman, a rival gang member, you know, you just bring in the MS-13, they do their thing. Well, we have these people coming into our country now. Can you say assassination of Joe Arpaio or assassination of some other prominent sheriff or a sheriff's advocate like Richard Mack? That this really frightens me that we have death squads coming into the United States right now, plus the pandemic people. And the money from this is coming out of Hamas. But where's the money Hamas is getting to procure the arms in the first place? The CIA.
Oh, that's a great question and an obvious answer as well, yes. Okay.
Yeah, and so the CIA. And remember what I said earlier. The CIA, I believe, is teaching West Africans to speak Spanish to blend in as an immigrant group to fool the Border Patrol people. And Dr. Orient said that there's 100,000 of them. That's what the Border Patrol sources have told her. I asked my source, how many are there? And he said, a lot. I don't know the number. And he said, it is curious that they do, a lot of them do speak Spanish. And he said, some of them try to say they're like from Guatemala, but he said, when you question them further, you know they're lying.
Well, yeah, you can tell by the dialect, and of course, you know, further questioning. Dave, forgive me, let me go backwards a little bit in your conversation, because I did get an email here, and I think it's worth posing the question to you. You're talking about our military men being on, and women being on these ships out at sea. This emailer, and Karen, it's a great question, by the way, Karen, thank you. It says, please ask Dave about how the Navy personnel on the ships intend to or can would be able to protect their families here on shore, because they've got families on shore here. What are they being told, or what's the deal with that?
I have no idea. I have found no one connected to these war games that's talking. I have a confidential source, and he knows of these documents intimately, and I can't say how intimate because it would give away his identity. But he knows of these documents intimately because I called him 2 years ago when I got a hold of it. And we met for lunch, and I showed them to him, and he goes, oh, yeah, yeah. And I can't tell you his connection to this because it would give it away, but he's a man who knows what he's saying. And what he said to me, he said that they're rotating people in and out. They'll do this for these war games. They'll call it, you know, new personnel operational training. Or if you train as a gunner's mate, they might bring you the next time back in and you're an electrician's mate. And so they say All right. they're trying to build collateralized skills, and that's one of the ways that they're justifying it, you know, in the PR thing, as they're teaching a multitude of skills. Because if you're attacked and you lose 200 sailors in your crew, you have to have people do different jobs so your ship can stay afloat. And that's the arguments they're giving.
Okay.
Now, as far as their family goes, no one's talking. And I asked him this. I said, I need to speak to someone who's involved in this particular activity. I said, I hear nothing. It's like a, I said, I have the map. I showed him the map. I said, you're telling me, is this a made-up map, and these congressmen and senators are all mad about this, and it's over nothing? Or are there real people here that are out here to see doing these things? And he goes, oh, there's real people out there. He said, but none of them are going to talk to you. He said,
okay.
none of them are going to talk to anybody. Because, see, it's not that they want, when the military leaks something, like when people brought me the Benghazi story about Ham and Guyette, they wanted that out there because they want people to see how dirty the Obama administration is. In this particular instance, I see why they're not saying anything to anybody, because this is, they're in their own self-protective mode. So why would you give away what you're doing?
Right, exactly. And obviously, the folks, and Karen, the people, we'll just say the lower level people may just not know. I mean, as my source says, the lie is different at every level, so they may be subjected to a lie that would make them feel like, hey, no big deal.
Well,
so I get that.
I just, you know, I know that you've been hot on the Ukraine, and you've had some great tips there. I think it fits into this whole scenario. The thing I vacillate on, though, guys, is will the war come after the martial law crackdown or before? Now, to me, it would make more sense to get the guns out of American hands and subjugate America early so you can't oppose the war effort.
I agree with that. I mean, in theory. But how in the heck would they do that, though? And you're saying, if I'm hearing this correctly, you're saying, well, they would do this asymmetrically through perhaps an EMP type of a preemptive type of an attack.
Well, I think we're going to get a two-edged sword. There's no question we're headed for pandemic releases and outbreaks. And I think that the excuse will be the immigrants and gee whiz, we didn't know. But I will tell you, and it's something that I talked to Joe about earlier today, we have stuff ready to go right now to release. And I'm saying some of the dark agencies on the black ops side. And I want to harken back to, and I don't mean to sound like I'm self-promoting here, but I want to harken back to an article I wrote in 2012, and I need to tell a bit of a personal story to illustrate, I think, the sincerity of what I'm bringing forward.
Sure.
Back in 1997, on the campus that I taught on, the Maricopa County health officials came on, and they were asking for emergency volunteers in case of a terrorist chemical biological attack, and I was dumb and naive at that time, and I thought terrorism was real to some degree. So I volunteered because they said I would get the drugs first for my family. So I was all too happy to volunteer, and nothing happened. Well, within a couple of years, or a few years, FEMA came online, and we were in a transition period with FEMA, and I got to attend a few meetings voluntary, but I wanted to meet FEMA people, and I wanted to see what this was all about. So I met a man, and he was in counterterrorism against biological and chemical weapons attacks. And it just so happened his daughter was a freshman in my undergraduate psychology class at the time. And so we kind of struck up a friendship. And then a couple years later, I had his other daughter in one of my classes. And so we stayed in off and on contact through the years. Well, the last year I was coaching basketball at the college level, he and his wife showed up at my office unannounced. I didn't even know they knew where my basketball office was on campus. And they just showed up. They were waiting for me at the door as I walked back into the building. And he said, we're bugging out in 2 months. Now, I wrote about this event at the end of December, the last week in December of 2012 on my website. And I think it's entitled something like WireX Intel, WireX government officials going into hiding. He told me of his plans to relocate to the southeastern seaboard area, but in a very remote location with like-minded FEMA and DHS people who he had made contacts with through the years. And he said they had a self-sustaining community. And I said, well, what's happening? And then he said, well, you know where you live out in the country. I live about 20 miles northwest of metropolitan Phoenix out in the country. He said, where you live, you're really in a pretty good position. He said, but there's chemical and biological weapons attacks coming. And he goes, this stuff drifts on the wind, and you should probably get some kind of protection. And I said, are you serious? He goes, Dave, we have stuff that even the Mossad doesn't know we have. And he specifically mentioned them. He goes, they know pretty much everything we do. They don't know. We have stuff that can literally change a person's DNA. We have stuff that can turn them into zombie-acting characters. And he said, watch this drill that we do in 2 weeks. And it was the October 31st, 2012 drill in San Diego. And I actually have this on one of my stories, where people were dressed up with makeup artists to act like zombies, and they were being shot down in a simulation, and it was a FEMA DHS civil control drill in San Diego, and they reported it on the San Diego TV stations, and they made a joke out of it because it was Halloween and zombies and all this stuff.
But I remember that.
He said, we have the ability to make people behave this way. And he said, and we use the chemtrails, nanotechnology. He said, it's all here. And I said, okay, now give me the good news. I said, when is all this going to happen? He goes, you know, no one knows a time frame. He goes, but there's a reason I'm leaving now. It could happen next week. He said, I don't think we have 2 years. And that was October of 2012. And at the end of that semester, he pulled his other daughter, third daughter, out of high school. And she was one of the more promising athletes in Arizona. And I thought it was disruptive to her potential college recruiting. This is how seriously they took it. I've heard from the family a few times since they've gone, which is now we're coming up, we're about a year and a half out now, and one of the daughters asked me to write a recommendation for graduate school and that kind of stuff, which I was happy to do. And he says, it's coming, Dave. He says, you know, I'm not going to say a lot on the phone, but it's coming. And he says, we're closer than you'd realize from what I'm hearing. And they're prepared to hunker down, and he knows that there are going to be troops running through the towns and killing people and taking people to FEMA camps. I mean, he's gone through the whole scenario with me. I mean, it's going to be absolute social chaos. So there are people inside the government that are reacting, you know, like who recently retired. They're reacting the same way. They know what's coming. Now, I think these poor guys on the ships, to answer that one of your listeners' questions, I don't think anything beyond below a captain's level rank would know any idea of what's coming. They're just carrying out their mission.
And I agree with you on that. And by the way, folks, I mean, where in history have we seen this before? If you recall the Cuban Missile Crisis during that period of time. In fact, I think this was reflected on one of the television programs or made for movie TVs or in fact, on the big screen where certain people in Washington in leadership capacities were quietly going to camping stores and getting camping equipment, tents, and what have you. And there was one scene I remember distinctly where two people from the same department in D.C. had met each other purchasing outdoor living supplies, camping supplies, in preparation of this going hot at that time back in 1962.
That's right. Yeah, so, I think so. Yeah.
So we. Yeah. I mean, we have a precedent here. You know, there is a precedent.
Yeah, I was just a little kid then, in '62, and my dad had retired. We should probably talk one night about my dad. He had a really interesting life in the Navy, but he retired, and he was working at Martin Marietta. And he was working with captured German scientists. Now, they did not call it, what was the name of that project, Paperclip?
Right.
They weren't calling it Paperclip. He never called it that. He never heard it called that. But we had, my family was German-speaking to a large extent on my dad's side because, you know, he was born in Germany, and My grandmother lived with us, and so we spoke a lot of German in the household then when I was little. And I remember him having these German scientists over, at least he said they were scientists, and they'd speak German. And they thought it was really funny that I knew some of the words they were speaking. So I do remember the event. But anyway, when the Cuban Missile Crisis went down, it was about 3 weeks before it became public, he came home one day, got out his Navy uniform that he hadn't worn, gosh, in probably 4 or 5 years, and said, I'm being pulled back into the Navy. And my mom broke out into hysterics. And I mean, it's an event etched in my mind. And then he went to Lari Air Force Base, boarded a plane, and he was gone for a month. He was they brought him back in active duty for 60 days for the Cuban Missile Crisis. And I don't know what he did in there, but I've seen the panic of it. But here's what I saw happen during that time. He wasn't the only one called back in, because we lived in an area not real far from Lari and Fitzsimmons bases in the Denver area. And so we had a lot of military families in our area. Some of the other fathers that we knew, I could think of maybe 3 or 4, and they didn't speak. They just went and did their job, just like these people on the ships are. These people who are out to sea tonight, and they're doing whatever they're doing in this mission, they don't know why they're doing it.
Right.
I mean, we know more about why they're doing it than they do. But do I think their carrier task force commanders do? Yeah, I think there's probably a pretty good idea. They know what they're doing and why they have to keep the charade going. I mean, Doug, can you think of any reason? You've seen the map right there. That's an official map from AFAST. I can even provide the entire document I can send to you. I had a friend of mine from the State Department who has great computer skills lift that map off the AFAST document because I didn't have the expertise. But I have the entire document that has AFAST, and they describe the entire operation. So I'd be happy to send that to you as an attached file to validate the existence of that map coming from official Navy sources. But what to me is really interesting is I ask people this question, and I've asked them a lot in the last few days. Can you look at that map and give me one legitimate reason why you'd have a war game at this magnitude on all three of our coastlines, including our territories like, well, former Philippines territory, Guam, Wake, even out to Hawaii, Cuba, Bermuda Islands is involved in this as well, too. They have these same drills out there. What legitimate reason could there be, other than what I'm saying, that would justify this operation?
Yeah, crickets at the moment.
Yeah, and not only this
operation.
Well,
here's what some people will say. That's why I asked the question in my article yesterday before I broke the news today. I wanted to see what the public would say. So I said, the final section in the article yesterday said a riddle. And it said, can you think of a reason? And I told you earlier, the number one reason people gave was that it was going to keep people in the country from running from ship when martial law broke out. And that, I don't, it's a good guess because we have a lack of facts, but I clearly see that's not it. It just doesn't make any sense. And one other person said this, well, we're going to go to war and they want to be in a constant state of readiness. Okay, but you don't put your military in fixed positions if you're going to war. Didn't we learn that at Hickam Field before Pearl Harbor?
Yeah. And
I mean, that doesn't make any sense either.
Right, yes.
So that is, I have racked my brain over this, and I say, tell me something different. What really got me thinking this is going to be an EMP false flag attack are two things. The ships are out of the way by being out of their ports and should largely be unaffected. But number two, what happened in Yemen, and we have a CIA guy and we have the head of NERC saying this could come to America. And I thought, uh-oh, that's why they're doing this. That's when it hit me. When I read the Yemen account, it rolled around in my head for a while, and I said, that's it. This is going to be, and let me give you a timetable. If I were to write this as a Hollywood movie, here's what I would do. Scene one, we have an Ebola outbreak. Dustin Hoffman appears on the movie screen, and he shows the Ebola map that was in that movie called Outbreak 20 years ago. And Mr. President's going to be here in 1 day, and in 2 days it'll be here, in 3 days it'll blanket the country. Here's what we need to do. And that real famous scene from that movie. So then you bring out the UN peacekeepers, and people aren't going to reject their help because the emergency rooms are going to be overrun, hospitals are going to be filled, people are going to be told to stay home and treat your own. So here comes the UN, all too willing to help. That's their foothold. That's their hold in the door. Meanwhile, you keep bringing in these fifth column insurgents to support the occupation force for martial law that they're going to be putting together behind the scenes. Now you need a false flag attack to take it from a medical intervention operation to a martial law occupation force. And I think the EMP is going to be one of the things that we see.
You know, interesting quote from Mark Twain. And folks, think about this as Dave Hodges is talking. The truth is stranger than fiction, but it is because fiction is obliged to stick to possibilities. Truth isn't. Think about that for a moment as you're considering what Dave Hodges is saying. Let me repeat that. Truth is stranger than fiction, but it is because fiction is obliged to stick to possibilities. Truth isn't. Isn't that interesting?
Well, it really is, and if you look at last year, and I think I've mentioned this on your show, between July and November 14th, the Grid X drill, FEMA, DHS, and their ancillary organizations ran 9 major disaster drills. And I've talked to people who understand this business. They say, we're lucky typically if we can do one every 6 months. And one in a year is not uncommon. And to have 9 in that period of time. You know, one of the drills was they had 386,000 foreign troops. And I took this off the NEC website. So this is the website that writes these disaster preparedness drills that they publicize for FEMA and DHS. And one of the drills, they had 386,000 troops being trained in the following areas. Now, tell me this doesn't get your attention. One, how to speak English. And if you're going to occupy a country, you got to speak English. And number two, how to use American weapons. Gee, maybe that's where those 2.2 billion rounds of ammunition DHS is collecting is going to. That's right there in their documents. They say that's the purpose for... Oh, and they were training them in urban warfare.
Wow.
Three for three, Doug. Three for three.
Interesting. And I'm getting a lot, Dave, look, I got to throw this question in before the top of the hour here. I'm getting a lot of questions from people who are listening live from Canada, all the way from, all the way from British Columbia through Newfoundland, saying, look, they're getting no information up there. They don't have any whistleblowers, basically. There's hardly any talk going on, and absolutely no one in this one also named Karen, also writing, saying that no one I know believes any of this. In other words, you know, it's difficult to talk with people who are stuck in the traditional paradigm. But anyway.
Well, let me address that very quickly.
Yeah.
I am happy to say that I'm not the sole purveyor of this information, thank God, because, you know, I went through a real tough time end of May, beginning of June, when I think I had something exclusive that was exclusive for about 3 days. And you know what I went through.
Yeah.
And so Drudge reported today, and the reason I found this out is people are sending this to me to my comments section of my website. He's running a similar story that jihadists are going to take down the power grid. I think the disinfo campaign's already started.
Okay, and that's fine. Let me just say this. Karen wants to know, basically, how is this going to affect Canada? And I get this question so much from so many Canadians, thinking that perhaps they're insulated from the, they're out of the direct line of fire, but in fact, this would affect them pretty much the same way, wouldn't it?
Well, they're incorrect about being unaffected, and they don't know the arrangements their own government has signed. Under the Security Prosperity Partnership Agreement, SPP, or the North American Union for short, Canada and Mexico have both signed agreements to bring in troops to assist the United States in case of domestic insurrection.
All right. So,
And I've reported that before on my website, and I put the appropriate documents.
But in terms of the average person, average citizen living in Canada, they'd be just as vulnerable as the average person in the United States, wouldn't
they? Well, I forget the name of the community because I don't have the story up before me, but I actually wrote on this about a year ago. Do you remember the Canadian community? I don't remember if they had floods or wildfires, but they evacuated the community, and when the people came home, the Royal Mounted Police had taken all their guns. Do you remember that story?
I'm racking my brain.
Yeah.
Joe is throwing a paper at me here.
They did. And these people had big protests and this and that, but the Royal Mounted Police entered these people's homes illegally while they were in this forced evacuation and just flat took their guns. So you're not going to be unaffected, people. You know, one of the biggest abuses we got going on in our country is CPS abuse, taking kids, and then they let them kind of slip out of sight and they go into child sex trafficking. Hello, British Columbia, Vancouver, British Columbia, is one of the hot spots for this in the Western democracies. You're not unaffected by that either. You're going to go through in Canada the same thing here, and that's why I say this to my Canadian brothers and sisters. You guys make great neighbors. I love your country and your cultures. You've been a terrific neighbor and friend to us all these years. We need to side together because your government is just as corrupt as my government. And we need to be on the same side. Your leaders have signed the same agreements that our leaders have here in the United States.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Wow. Wow. Folks, you're listening to Mr. Dave Hodges, the Common Sense Show, heard every Sunday night. Go to thecommonsenseshow.com. And they're very nicely well-designed, well-redesigned website, a good-looking website. There you can find information about Mr. Hodges, his program, and, of course, his latest articles.
Well, I appreciate that plug. My website master is Leslie Kitzman, my goddaughter, and my favorite niece.
Well, give her props for me. I'll tell you that.
We're going to take a break now, and on the other side of the break, Dave, I want to go back to the border and get into a few things we talked about earlier, points you made, and I'd like to get into some of these a little bit more if we could, because there's so much here that people need to understand that this is not happening by chance, and this is not it's not what is being portrayed in the media, how it is happening, nor what is really happening, is being portrayed, and how it will tie it back into what we're talking about with the drills that are being conducted, the international drills that are being conducted. Folks listening to the Hagmann and Hagmann Report on this Friday, July 25th, 2014, with our guest, Mr. Dave Hodges, his website, The Common Sense Show. His radio show is on Sunday nights, and it's a fantastic show. You can download it and get the podcast right off iTunes or from his website, and it's a must listen to. We'll be right back after these short messages. Stay with us.
And welcome back, folks, to a free-for-all Friday night. It is Friday, the 25th day of July, 2014. Our very special guest tonight, a good friend of the program, Mr. Dave Hodges. We respect his information, his research, his integrity, character, and, of course, the information he provides to us. And we thank him for being a beacon of truth, the beacon of light, and the beacon, a warning bell, if you will, on the horizon. Now, Dave, during the break, I picked up the bat phone, okay, and I said, "Hey," and I summoned I summoned W. He's a intelligence insider. I said, "Are you listening to this?" He said, "Oh yeah, I am." And I said, "Well, okay, just to be sure, because some of this sounded really familiar." And of course, you were mentioning weapons coming into Mexico, and one of the here's a couple of things, Dave, that I'll tell you. And folks, if you recall back, if you go to HomelandSecurityUS.com on the right hand side of our website, I've had an audio clip I've left purposely up since May, and that's of Tosh Plumlee. He was a CIA operative that ran weapons for the CIA. And at one point during that interview, and some points are obviously difficult to hear because of the audio, gee, wonder why, he suddenly realized, hey, wait a minute, there are anti-aircraft weapons in Mexico. Okay, and why are they there, and how did they get there, and et cetera? Well, this goes back to, Dave, what you said about Benghazi. And folks wrote an article. I'm going to toot my own horn here about the article I wrote about how all things are connected. Nothing does happen in a vacuum. Well, how things are connected, whether it's at the southern border or West Africa or North Africa or the Middle East. And he said, don't you remember, and listen to what Dave Hodges is saying, don't you remember what Tosh Pumley said about anti-aircraft weapons being found in Mexico? So, Joe, is he on with us at this point? Okay, so we're waiting for him to come on, Dave. I want him to comment on this directly to you, and you and him have the discussion.
Well, let me tell you what I didn't mention earlier, and I was mentioning the weapons cache. Yep. Anti-tank weapons, the AK-47, you know, typical you'd find, but also RPGs. And I was told 15,000 by this DEA special agent is what their intelligence revealed. I really want to get into more of the DEA special agent revelations here with regard to money laundering and the whole nine yards. I mean, our entire financial system is corrupted. There's nowhere you can go that is an honest bank, and I mean nowhere.
Unless you've got the smallest of the small, and I don't even think they exist anymore, maybe, but even then, you still have the oversight, which is corrupt anyway, so my goodness. Okay, folks, this is fascinating stuff, the things that you're not going to hear on the evening news. So go ahead, sir.
Well, I think that when you look at what this agent told me, and I have to tell you, let me make an admission of what a chicken I am, okay? I used to be a third-degree black belt in my younger days, but I was too afraid to meet with this guy in person for a while until I learned to trust him. And another thing, too, I thought, too, what if we're being tracked? And I told him this. He goes, I understand your hesitancy. I said, look, I'm writing stuff about what's coming in from the border, and you're calling and confirming it, and what you're giving me are the deep cover sources and how it's being money laundered. I said, so you're filling in pieces of stuff I already know about. I said, what's to prevent someone who's listening to both of us from tracking us through our cell phones and then doing away with us when we walk out of a restaurant together?
Yeah.
And so, listen, on that basis, that's why I was really, really hesitant. And then when I finally did, I made sure I had security. I had perimeter security in place.
I got to tell you, my friend, I have turned down several meetings that didn't feel right or were otherwise strange. We do have our intelligence insider to directly speak to you, and you guys can talk amongst yourselves, if you will, about this very issue. W is our intelligence insider. And he reminded me about what Tosh Pumley was talking about the weapons, about the aircraft, and the aircraft batteries in Mexico and so on. And this is all firsthand information. So, W, go ahead, sir.
Hey, Dave. You know, one other thing I did want to mention, you were mentioning Peru. Of course, back in the 80s, we had Shining Path, which was the Chinese group, which was just unbelievably vicious in that part of the world, and some of the stories of things they did are just not even speakable. But in order to instill terror, in order to get where they were trying to go. But I don't know if you guys mentioned it, and I missed just a couple minutes of your conversation. The other thing that needs to be talked about in conjunction with South America and Central America is the connection of West Africa and AQIM with the drug gangs and the governments, these corrupt governments in the Four Corners region down in the east coast of Central America. And the drugs going from South America over to Africa and then up into Europe. AQIM, which was also present at Benghazi, AQIM is the wealthiest, richest of the jihadist groups operating in the Mideast. And the reason they're the richest is because they haven't got a compunction about dealing the drugs up into Europe. The real numbers of members of AQIM doesn't mean they have don't have a lot of operatives. They have people that they bring in to do things and pay off from other groups. But the actual organization itself has been reportedly only in about 350, 400 people range. They're a very tightly held group, which of course is indicative also of an intelligence operation where they may be contracting out aspects or working with other groups on aspects of it, but actual command and control is a very small number of people in coordinating the movement of drugs. And then one of their things that people would remember, they received drugs were, whole jetliner. 737 or whatever be flown from Africa or from South America over to Africa full of drugs, and then there's so much value in the drugs they just belly plant, land the aircraft in and load the drugs off and leave the plane there to burn. But the arms coming out of West and North Africa and then going back over to South America, those arms are destabilizing governments in South and Central America and moving north, and, of course, become a threat to us, including even the gas weapons and other things. And if you'll also recall, it was through Mexico that the persons came to take out the Saudi ambassador. A couple of years back. And so when people think that border, they poo-poo whether or not that's a threat with jihadists coming in to the country to do dastardly deeds. Remember, they were going to come in here and kill the Saudi ambassador at a restaurant in Washington, D.C.
Right.
So, this is a very, very real threat. And part of the problem, when we mention drugs or, Ebola, Ebola takes out its victims very quickly. So if somebody has Ebola, within literally just a matter of days at the most, they show the signs of the infection, and they don't get a chance to infect lots and lots of people before they show that they're infected, and it's a little bit easier to quarantine. But there's other types of disease where the incubation period is longer. And as the incubation period gets longer, the ability for them to spread disease widely before it's suddenly detected, and then you can't corral it easily, that's a real threat. Well, if we look at these weapons, if we look at these gang members like a disease, when they come in but we don't see their actions immediately, then we don't corral them, stop that movement quickly, and it continues to spread and spread and spread. And then by the time that the first action by them is seen, it's already too late because they're so far and wide spread out. And their interconnectivity, command and control, they've got a chance to get themselves in place. And so that we haven't seen some horrible event happen quite yet isn't that it's a good thing. In some ways, it's a bad thing because it means that the infection is continuing to spread and continuing to get a root. And when it finally does begin to show itself, we're far more vulnerable. And, this is so invasive, what's happening to us. It's such a tremendous threat. So it's important, and like you were mentioning with the sheriffs and other people, the society operates on a very thin thread of civility. And as soon as you have just a handful of people taken out, others can't go do their job, and suddenly everything we know about our type of society collapses very quickly. It does go into some kind of martial law type situation, and our ability to get back to some kind of normative state is going to take a very long time. So those are real threats.
Yeah, I'll mention something about the Ebola incubation period. I had on my show Dr. Jane Orient, who's one of our top physicians here in Arizona where I reside, and she informed me that the incubation period for Ebola can be up to 3 weeks. Now, she said it doesn't always take 3 weeks, but can it be up to? Now, one of the things about pandemics that I've learned in my research, and Dr. Orient confirmed this, a lot of them, and you're kind of alluding to this, will burn themselves out. If you get to quarantine the people who are exposed early, then you can really kind of limit and you'll burn the virus out. The problem is there's multitudes of viruses coming in, and some of them are going to be carried by mosquitoes. In fact, Barb Peterson, who did some research on horizontal transfer of diseases through mosquitoes, this has now been engineered to make it possible. And in addition, you have air travel, and they're taking these illegal aliens and they're transporting them all over the country, either by bus or by plane. So you don't have to wait like in the old movie Outbreak, where it starts on the East Coast and works its way west. It's going to be everywhere all at once. And
well,
so
that's also presuming, Dave, that it is a natural outbreak as opposed to an engineered outbreak.
Yeah, you know, I alluded to that with Doug and Joe in the first hour when I talked about my former FEMA contact, personal friend who went into hiding saying, we've got stuff out there that could be released.
Yes.
That will spread like wildfire and the world doesn't know we have it.
Well, and the other thing, just as a very rapid aside, we know that we had the persons on MH17 that were going down to the AIDS conference, and one of the subjects that was going to be voted on and discussed was whether or not they were going to sign a document together stating that the AIDS virus was a genetically engineered, genetically targeted disease developed in South Africa, and you know, say that it was man-made, and you know, I suppose we'll never know the true facts on that at this point. With all those people out, that just isn't going to come out. But you know, certainly other things that are out there could be of a similar nature, similar threat. At the very least, this population coming in provides great cover if that was going to be done or happen out in the future. But, you know, I was looking at the gang members as being really almost like a virus, just as a correlation, where they get in here and get a root and get their systems in place before the actual coordinated action begins. And I think it's similar to an Ebola. I mean, it's going to rip the guts out of the country.
Well, one of the things that I looked at, and I used to teach military history a long, long time ago, is that the normal rule of thumb, it takes one soldier per 50 citizens to garrison a country, all things being equal. And I don't think the UN is going to be able to generate enough manpower early on to completely control the country. This is why I think you have to introduce pandemics and weaken a significant number of the country and reduce those numbers. But I think this is why groups like MS-13 are here. You'll have your blue-helmeted troops by day, and you'll have your terrorists by night going out and making political hits designed to preserve what's coming in.
Well, and also, if you go back to Larry Abraham, my old friend who passed away here a few years back, and Gary Allen with their book, None Dare Call It Conspiracy, the way they described this effort to control the middle class was like a vice. And so we have corrupt government on one side and then a criminal element on the other side squeezing us in the middle class like a vice and holding us in place. And that's really, again, what's happening here. You know, they don't change it. They're using the same old tricks over and over and over again. And this is, you know, what we're talking about here. So I didn't want to intrude into the conversation other than I want people to be aware of this South American situation with the drugs coming north. And by the way, Raul Castro goes back and forth to Venezuela repeatedly and is pretty heavily you know, involved there with a lot of these operations related to the drug and weapons running through that Four Corners region, and that's been pretty widely reported by a number of folks. And this is not some, you know, benign, low-grade activity that's been going on for a number of years. It's just now reached that point where it's become so, so critical because the swarm coming across into the country is so great, and our population, while they may be watching and activated, they're being, you know, hands tied behind their back. You know,
yeah, well, you're exactly right.
In a normal situation.
I want to read something to you very briefly, W, before you go, that kind of validates the corridor into Europe connection here. This came from a DEA special agent that approached me, and I was speaking about him before you called in. And this is a quote from a written communique he provided to me. This has also gone to Congress, and they're ignoring it. He said, "We also noted that Peruvians associated with the Pacific Gateway," and that was the first point of entry for money laundering in this country, "were operating in Phoenix and Connecticut. Phoenix made sense to us because of its proximity to the border, but not Connecticut. That's until you return to the flow of money. Financial analysis showed that the Metmex Panolis, a Mexican gold company, is headquartered in Connecticut. At that time, Metmex, an Italian gold company called Ital Preziosi, who is connected to Islamic terror financing and drug and gun distribution into Europe." So there's your connection, starting with Peru, going into Europe in the way you're describing.
Well, and remember, you know, people have forgotten now, or they just weren't awake watching this at the time, and a lot of the audience here is younger than we are, but BCCI, Bank of Crooks and Criminals International, was really a cover operation for money laundering and
yes,
drug running. Of course, we were monitoring that, but we were in it, too. At the time, this is back during the 80s and early 90s before there was work to expose it and stop what was going on. But a lot of those connections were northeast coast United States banking connections, et cetera. And so you had this distance in order to separate the banking crimes from the drugs and allow it to look like they were totally isolated or separate. And the other thing I'll mention, of course, going into Arkansas Development Finance Authority, as well as the other nine finance authorities around the country, they were covers for money laundering. Of course, Larry Nichols talked about that back in the 90s pretty extensively, and a number of others. And that was where these state pseudo public-private state organizations, for example, Arkansas Development Finance Authority, would issue a bond, and the bond would be set up by these law firms, in this case Rose Law Firm, where Hillary worked with Vince and Hubble, Vince Foster and Webb Hubble, and they were writing these bonds that were then listed out of the New York exchanges, where the money would come in from South America and buy these bonds up that were subpar, subprime returns. And the only persons that would buy it would be, you know, somebody that was a nut, wouldn't be grandma, or it wouldn't go into your normal things. They weren't, you know, AAA rated and things like that. Well, then who would loan the money out once it got into that agency? The only person, for example, in Arkansas that had signing authority was the governor. So the governor would then sign a check on these loans going out to a corporation like Tyson Chicken, and they'd get this loan money to expand their operations and create jobs and things like that, or Park-O-Meter, which was where the receiver mechanisms for the AR-15s to convert them into M-16s were being made, Webb Hubble's son or son-in-law is my recollection, and things like that. So this was a money laundering operation being conducted inside the states with the governors involved, et cetera. They didn't know all the details. They just knew he'd sign here and give this check to those guys. It's pretty easy to be a pretty successful company if you get these loans and then you don't have to pay the money back. And, of course, that's what Larry Nichols talked about, that he was there inside ADFA. And all of these accounts where they're making these loans, nobody ever paid any money back. They never paid on their loans. The money went one way. Well, why? Because it was a way of money laundering, and no taxes were owed because it's a loan. And it went to corporations here in the United States. Where are companies like Walmart located, and things like that. And there was other states involved also. Well, again, this was drug money that was sustaining our system.
Are you saying that Walmart got started, at least in part, with drug money?
I don't know Walmart specifically, all the details there. I know that Tyson Chicken, according to Larry, and we spent a tremendous amount of time together on some of these issues, was one that he talked about directly, but there was numerous other companies involved. I mean, if you recall back during the Whitewater stuff, Rose Law Firm had literally garages full of paperwork of all of these companies that got loans through ADFA, and they never were paying any back up on the loans. And, of course, you had front companies that were related suppliers to other bigger companies, so you would have to go through the steps to identify all of them. But, for example, let's talk about Walmart. You know, what was one of the things that happened when Clinton was in office, they, in the White House, they built this huge airport up there in northern Arkansas for Walmart to fly in and out of, and part of it was a FEMA thing. And so the assertions were on a number of people's part that, like Denver, we have all the operations underneath the airport. Because when you're putting all that concrete and you have the ability to build other stuff underneath it, nobody's, you know, sees trucks kind of going with dirt and concrete and everything else, you're not even thinking what else is going on with it. And the assertion was that there's quite a bit more going on at Arkansas. So
Capital,
that airport, yeah.
Capital Management Services, and you have Stevens Investments.
And that's a great point. You know, Stevens Investments, Stevens Investments there in Arkansas, at the time in the 90s, that was the largest off-Wall Street brokerage firm on planet Earth. So you could go to Tokyo, you could go to Hong Kong, you could go to Germany, London. The largest off-Wall Street brokerage firm in the world was Stevens Investment. Well, in Little Rock, Arkansas, you know, remember, Arkansas is arguably the 49th state economically in the country, and probably really the 50th, you know, with a race going on between Mississippi and Arkansas. And then, you know, we put a man in the White House from the least productive state or almost the least productive state in the country. What's going on here? You know, the reason you want weak leaders in office is because they're controllable. You want people who have bones that can be exposed if they have a problem. That makes them manipulable. So, but I don't want to take from what you're saying, Dave. I just wanted to.
Well, I think this is tremendous stuff, because a lot of what you're saying, not all of it, the Arkansas stuff you're giving is just fascinating, and I know a little bit, but not a lot. But the BCCI stuff, I've all heard that before. I interviewed Robert Mazur, who helped bring down the Escobar cabal from the inside, and he gave me the A to Z on BCCI, which is the modern day version of HSBC Bank. And there's a guy out there, and guys, I don't know if you're aware of who John Cruz is, but I've had John on my show three times, and he's a great guest. He's not born in the conspiracy world. He couldn't tell you much about 9/11 and stuff like this, but he knows about money laundering from the drug cartels. He was a VP at HSBC, and he went out to do due diligence on some of these accounts that looked suspicious to him, and he'd show up at their place, and they'd find foreigners working like in a small office pod, and they were calling it a house on the applications, and it was just a boiler room for telephone calls, and he concluded that they were doing massive drug laundering. He kept quiet for a while, and he tracked it, and he tracked it back to the Sinaloas and the Los Zetos and the Mexican drug cartels. He went to his boss, and his boss says, you will shut up, you will drop it, or we'll fire you. Well, he wouldn't, and he didn't want to go to jail and be the fall guy. So he went to DHS and the FBI and a bunch of other federal agencies, and they told him to go away. He went to the Manhattan District Attorney, where they told him, yeah, you're a hold of this. Russian mafia is involved as well. It's not just the Mexican drug cartels. We know all about it, and nothing's going to happen. And if you know what's good for you, you'll shut up. And I'm sorry, I don't remember the name of his book, because I didn't know I was going to talk about him tonight. But if you Google John Cruz, C-R-U-Z, and HSBC bank scandal, you'll come up with it. It's a great read, and he'd be a terrific guest for you, Doug, because he knows this story inside and out, and he sounds a lot like W here in the way he's describing it.
Well, the main thing is that, and Doug, you'll remember that I've discussed this with you off air a number of times, but this drug aspect of whether you're talking about Afghanistan and the Cebu case, these cases out of South America with the tie-ins to the drugs, you know, we look at the terrorist side of it, but how are they financing? You go back to why Reagan did what he did in the 80s and Bush won as VP hitting the Drug Interdiction Task Force, and that was about allegedly centralizing the drug trade to Colombia so that only finished product would come out of Colombia to the United States. And, of course, that was what was coming up to MENA. And the other aspects of that, it wasn't just the drugs. It was also the chemicals going to process the drugs, as well as the money laundering related to that. And so we got a hold of all of those operations during that period of time and centralized them. And so that was the cover, if you will, for our involvement and working in this drug industry and shutting them down. And so when a lot of the public thought that we were corrupt in what we were doing, there was a legitimate argument there about why we were doing what we were doing. But during the Carter administration, they had gone out and they would take out the top people in these drug cartels, and then the lieutenants would come in and start up all their own operations. So you come in to office in the mid-70s and you got 50, 60 families that are running drugs. By the time you get to the end of the administration, you got 500, because it's like starfish, you chop them in half, you don't kill it. You get two, you throw them back in the water, you get two, because they keep growing. And that's sort of what was happening here. And so the kitchen cabinet came in. Casey had fielded some ideas, and they decided to centralize the drug trade where only finished product would come out of Colombia. And then the agreement was made with six families, one of which was taken out. To set an example, and then we were left with the five families that were dealing drugs coming up into the United States. They got good to go to get their drugs inside the United States, and then once they got to their regions through MENA, then they were fair game. If we got them, we got them. And then, of course, what was happening where people thought there was corruption in our police departments, and where the federal agents would go out to the various property rooms. We'd go out and we would take samples in property rooms all around the country of the cocaine coming up, and then and some of the heroines. And we would look to see if it had markers in it, because the chemicals that we were supplying, we took out most of the chemical manufacturers around the planet, and then we would look where we put these microtags in the chemicals, which at that time nobody even knew this was possible, and you had to have an electron microscope to find it. The chemicals that we were processing into our approved dealers out of Colombia, families out of Colombia, if we found the microtags in the cocaine, then we wouldn't follow up on those groups because we knew who they were. If we found cocaine that didn't have the microtags, we'd trace it back to its origins, usually Bolivia or Peru, one of the countries. Brazil, we took that out with a special forces operation early on. They had a huge facility with almost 200 planes and airports. It was unbelievable. And then when we'd find groups that were still dealing drugs into the U.S., the finished product, then we'd give the information to Colombians, who then had the very extreme reputation, and they'd go make them an offer they couldn't refuse. They either sell their paste to the Colombians for a set price, or they die. And they couldn't send finished product to them. So because we didn't have the stomach to go into another jungle war, we'd just come out of Southeast Asia, and the public just wasn't ready to be in any kind of a conflict, and we were being pressed like we are now, both by the Russians and the Chinese trying to open up fronts against us by using drug money to overturn governments in Central and South America.
That makes and a lot so, of sense, yeah.
Yeah, so
I
want to
ask, can I ask you something else along these lines before we leave this thought? Because you mentioned chemicals, and I want to read to you a brief statement from my DEA source and then tell you what he told me verbally to get your reaction. He said, Peru is now the leading cocaine producer, 324 metric tons. DEA and all Peruvian police and military interdict 12 metric tons, which is the cost of doing business. It's only 3 to 5% of the gross. And then he went on to tell me, he said, what they do to try to elevate their drug numbers, he goes, they're not even taking 3 to 5%. It's an unabated trade. He said what they'll do is they'll stop trucks carrying the chemicals used to process the cocaine, and then they'll basically greatly exaggerate the amount of chemicals they seize. But if they get the chemicals, they say they got the drug. Have you heard about that?
You know, that's stuff that's probably more recent than my involvement, and so I really wouldn't be able to stay authoritatively what's going on. I just know that with at this point in time, any kind of reports, I guess, you know, if I don't see it or know the person directly, I'd be pretty suspect of anything that was said, because it's just hard to get accurate information. And at this point, things have become so wild, you know, for people that are, let's say, DEA or intelligence agencies. You know, if they're good guys, they can't really talk about what they're doing. They're trying to do their job and keep their job and stay effective. But every one of them, if they're honest and they tell you the truth, they know that there's stuff that just they see every day, and they're just, you know, befuddled. They just can't make it equate with right or wrong. And most of the time, the reason is because there's these, you know, the lie is different every level. So there's other operations on top of other operations going on that they're supposed to look the other way, because they're not supposed to know that there's political reasons, there's other relationships further up that allow this group to survive, and that group has to be taken out because of the alliances. And then the only way I would equate that is, for example, when we were pumping in currencies into the Soviet Union, the people that were tied to Gorbachev, we would give them currencies, do trades and exchanges with them, but they would not be the same as the Yeltsin people. Why? Because we were puffing Yeltsin and we were weakening Gorbachev, but we dealt with both groups. It's just that we dealt with one far more favorably, so over time, the Yeltsin people had more wealth and won out. But in order to not stick up above the radar, we were dealing with all of them, so that you know, we could be viable, and that it wouldn't be obvious that we were picking one over the other. It looked like we were just doing trades with whoever we could do trades with. And the same thing with the drug stuff. There's a lot of times, in order to protect informants or connections, or, for example, with the banking, you know, we took out all of the banking stuff that was of one type, and then we'd sift in contacts and relationships that ended up being back to, say, BCCI, so that we could offer them alternatives after, you know, and a source that we might have filtered in, a contact that we might have filtered in over puffing him, because he's the genius who comes up with the connection that gets him a banking thing where he can get his money laundered, you know, safely. And so all of a sudden he's the go-to guy. Well, with his real connection, he's got, you know, intelligence agency connections. And I would use in part of that saying, you know, look at Tom Hall down in Costa Rica. He is shown in the Tower Commission reports, you know, during Iran-Contra, as this contact with intelligence agency contacts, friend, and with underworld contacts and friends. Well, he was OSS in World War II. You know, come on. He's still operational. To say that he's just some guy that has a ranch that just so happens to have an airport on it that costs $17 million for the Army Corps of Engineers to build as an emergency runway, and that happens to be where the drug flights are being refueled and the cargo's checked and before they come north, and the guns go before they go south. It was an agency operation. To say anything else is just, you know, it's not even sophomoric. And you can be in a room with people that are really important to you. Well, we don't really know that. Bullshit. Give me a break. That was done, overtly clandestinely almost. And we have lots of these operations where we have to, we have to be engaged at some level, engaging with the bad guys in order to have enough operational intelligence. And so we work with them. So, when you say they're all the guys in the banking side of it are bad, no. There's a lot of good guys in there trying to do their job, but somewhat further up the line, it gets twisted back to, aid these people that really want to take out the country. You know, it's like saying all the CIA guys are bad because they're, dealing drugs into the country. No, they're not. There are operations that have been going on. They're trying to identify the bad guys, and sometimes you got to look like a bad guy and get in there. That's spy versus spy stuff. But at some high, high level, you can get somebody in the links in the chain who actually, for all the right reasons, we're doing everything just right, and then at just the right moment, they twist or kink it somehow to do something else, and it's like all that work, all those people trying to choke down the drugs to stop it, and then it gets twisted somehow, and next thing you know, raiding the bad guys. I know it sounds convoluted, but that's the way it works in that kind of a world.
Dave? Comments?
Oh, did we lose Dave?
Joe?
No, he's still here.
Oh, okay.
Dave, did you just take a siesta there, buddy?
No, I'm right here. Can you hear me?
Yeah, now we can. All right.
Oh, I must have cut out. I'm sorry. What I wanted to ask too here and throw this out, one of the pieces of information I've come across is the DEA has now been ordered by the Department of Justice, and Eric Holder's involved in this as well, to when they seize guns in a drug bust, they used to destroy the guns. Now they're turning them over to ATF, specifically to ATF, no one else. And ATF, we know, is implicated in Fast and Furious. And what the DEA special agent was thinking, although he doesn't know for sure, is this Fast and Furious Part B being kept alive so there's a two-way traffic of guns to these cartels? What do you think about that?
Well, I mean, it's not just the guns, it's everything, but, the guns are certainly part of it. When Plumlee talks about that, he went down and saw the anti-aircraft weapons in these warehouses just across the border in Mexico, and they were American equipment, and they're in the control of the bad guys. They're not in control of the Mexican military good guys. What's that about? The light weapons are horrible, and they're going to kill people, but it's every kind of weapon. Remember, Dave, you may have been watching close enough at the time back during the Clinton administration when we had a couple of containers show up in the port in California. I believe it was at Long Beach. That had, and I don't remember the exact number, I remember it was 3,000 or 30,000. I'm sure people can search it on the internet and they'll know it exactly. It was just a very large quantity of AK-47s, as I recall, and they were fully automatic. And they happened to get found here in the U.S. port, but their actual end destination was supposed to be Mexico. and they were being transshipped. They weren't actually going to get these containers opened here. And then somebody went ahead and opened them, and here they found a couple of containers with all these fully automatic weapons going to Mexico. And it was totally illegal, and it was they were out of China. And it was just shocking. And you go, my gosh, you know, I don't remember if it was 3,000 or 30,000. So it was a large number. But can you imagine 3,000 fully automatic weapons getting into the hands of these gangs just right there next door? And if that stuff's coming up in here, you know, we have a lot of people talk about they're going to have their guns and their shotguns or else. Look, what wins in a gunfight? Lead down range. And if they've got machine guns, you're probably not going to make it.
Just yeah, that's it. True. And that, does that explain why police forces like the Phoenix PD are going to M16s?
Yeah. I mean, I don't know what police officer can operate in that kind of an environment if you don't have not just one back at the station, but a lot. And, you know, I have concerns about this militarization of the police forces. On the other hand, if we're going to let this kind of crowd come into the country, they better have armored vehicles because it's the only way they're going to survive it. It won't make it a week. So, you know, it's a sticky wicket. It's a problem any way you cut it. At the end of the day, you know, this border should be being controlled. And if it's not, it's, you know, we're probably toast.
Well, you know, just with the pandemic thing, here's what I've learned, and Dr. Orient knows the same thing, that when they were first bringing in these immigrants, they might have 100 in a particular facility. And if someone was shaking and had a fever, they would just put them on the other side, move everybody else over to the other side of the building, and put yellow tape down the middle and call it a quarantine.
Well, remember the Godfather movie? And the Godfather comes over, and they look at him for a second or two, decide he looks a little bit questionable. They put him in an isolated room for a month. He doesn't get to come out until they've had plenty of time to see if he's going to actually manifest any particular thing. That's the way it was done when it was done correctly. And we're not even in the same world today. And so the risk to us societally, you know, one of the things is, you know, we're in the summertime right now, but in a few weeks, these caseworkers are going to be required by the way that our state laws and federal laws are set up to place these kids into an educational setting.
Yeah, exactly.
And that situation means that those kids are going to be placed in direct contact with all of the rest of the citizens' kids. Now, having raised a few kids myself, I can tell you, anything the kids get, you know, when I don't have kids in the house, I don't get sick. When I get kids in the house, I'm sick every other week. Why? Because if it's out there, they bring it home. So you might not have seen what's about to come. Get to October and tell me what it's like. Get to November and tell me what it's
like. I've raised that same point with regard, because federal law says you cannot discriminate against someone because of citizenship, so they're all entitled to an education. The school districts can't keep them out of the schools even if they wanted to.
No. And they're gonna be walking them in there and requiring them to be in those settings. And then the parents, you know, if you're going to try and homeschool or take your kids out or whatever, where are you going to move them? They're going to require – you're going to have a fight to the moon. And at some level, the only thing I'll also add here, and, you know, it's a little bit of an aside, but it goes to what's really happening in the country. It's the feds, the federal government – forcing certain things onto the people, the citizens, that are contrary to their interests. And at some point, the breaking point is when leaders in some of these states say no and hell no. And the citizens force that kind of response by those leaders or communities. Even if the governors won't do it, the communities will. I think it's going to reach that level. And it's going to be a question of if they're able to force their will
on us adequately to get what they want done. And I think they're going to get pretty heavy-handed to try and keep that going. And, of course, the dollar thing is when the Fed breaks down and then you go into some kind of regionalization and fracture the country, shatter the country, because that's what holds the country together right now. If it wasn't for the federal money, then all you have left to entice, you know, you get the carrot and the stick. So right now they have money they can throw at you. If they haven't got that money, if the dollar goes through some kind of chaotic, you know, disintegration or is greatly, greatly weakened, the ability is printed endlessly, then the only thing they have left is the power of the gun and the fist. And so at that point, you know, whether people are going to put up with it or go along with it, you know, even to, you know, your kid has to be in school, then there you go. The states will try to back that up, but some states maybe more so than other states. And I think that's where you get into this fracturing of the country, dividing of the country, which is ultimately what the plan is anyway. Because if you go to more of a state type thing, a regional thing, based on trade, then your constitution, what's your constitution mean? Maybe you get the feds there or you don't. If you don't have the feds there, you don't have a constitution. You may have a state constitution, you may have other things, but it becomes very dizzying, disorienting, and I think it's a different world then.
Are you familiar with the concept Reconquista de Atlan?
You know, vaguely seems like I've heard of it. I can't say that it's...
Yeah, let me just... And I wrote an article about it, and I wasn't trying to suggest that it's going to be a literal implementation. I think it's probably more symbolic. But what Atlan is, it was the creation of Mecha, and Mecha at that time was being underwritten by La Raza, and this goes back to 2003. And what they called for was taking away parts of eight states in the Southwest and all the way up the seaboard into parts of Washington State, and creating a new land in which the European Americans would have to leave. And this would strictly be a Latino situation. Native Americans would be invited in as well to share. And it's their land by birthright that supposedly the United States stole from them. And what's interesting, though, even though that sounds like it's an idealistic bunch of nonsense promoted on a college campus by students with nothing better to do, Mayor Villagrosa out of Los Angeles has endorsed the idea.
Well, let me tell you something that happened personally with me. I was with friends, a name that every person in the audience would know instantly, and we happened to be in a home office, and he had a window cracked open because we were, you know, cooling the house down. It was early in the morning, it had been a hot night, his air conditioner unit was out, and so we were waiting for that to be serviced, and we were looking at some stuff, and that, and we were both reading, so we weren't talking, we were just quiet. And the pool guys come by to maintenance the pool. And so they're just outside the window. I'm busy reading something, not even thinking anything of it, and they're talking. And they don't realize that I, you know, speak Spanish and understand a little bit of it just from my work in those years. And so these guys are talking, and the one guy is right outside the window, and he's telling the other guy, "I really like this place. When we take over California, this is where I'm coming. This is my house." And I was just shocked. And I thought it was kind of a joke at the time. And then the other guy comes over, and they have another helper, and they're picking which houses they want and why and how they're going to take them out.
Wow.
And it was just, it was like, wow. And they just didn't. They thought they were having a private conversation just outside the window, and you know, that mentality exists out there, and I think that this is part of the reason why I think it's important that Doug is having the detective on Monday to talk about the Eugene Wayne.
Edward Wayne Edwards, yep.
Yes, and because we as a people
we try to project how we think, how our society works, even if it's got problems, etc. We project onto the people around us our way of thinking, and that, you know, even though we might entertain a pretty bizarre thought here or there, for the most part, we understand there's rules of the game and there's certain order and lawfulness that has to happen, or else nothing works. And so we think of our life and our society within the context, if somebody does something bad, I'm calling the cops. If something goes wrong, a judge will fix it. If we need to change the way things are going on, we can change who we vote in office, etc. But there's certain people out there who look at us like sheep to be sheared, the flim-flam man and things like that, these banking people, for example. But there's another element where there's a pure evil out there where they look at us as so stupid that we deserve to be clipped, murdered, destroyed, whatever, and they look forward to every opportunity to do that. And that's part of what my concern is. A lot of these gangs, a lot of these groups look at their degraded condition, their needs, their wants, and they see us as having stuff, not because we worked for and earned it, but because we stole it. And they've been told over and over and over and over and over all their life that the only reason we have anything is because we took it from them, we deprived them of it, we conned them. And in fact, this is part of what I've discussed even with Doug and his audience about this vilification that's happening here in the country, where we're being villainized, painted in this evil light, the ugly American, and all of our banking institutions, all of our politics, everything about us is corrupt and evil and everything else. And it's creating a mindset from all these different groups, be it the jihadists, be it our Russian opponents, our Chinese opponents, these South American gangs, etc. They're all being taught that we somehow deserve to be destroyed, that we have brought this upon ourselves because we have caused their pain by our actions and how we've conducted ourselves. And so they'll feel very righteous indignation, justification to come do whatever it is that they want to do. It's a different kind of vengeance. Think of how we were pumped up that because of 9/11, we're going to go get Saddam, we're going to go get those people in Afghanistan, waving the flag, righteous indignation, we're coming to get you. And the whole country gets rah, 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 okay? Well, these people are getting the same kind of cheerleading, and it's under the radar for most Americans. They do not understand, and they haven't dialed in the magnitude of the evil behind it, because they haven't personally ever looked evil, evil, evil in the eye. They don't have the fear in them yet, and it won't be until they're facing it eyeball to eyeball that they suddenly get it, but it might be too late. And right now is the moment to dial it up and understand we are in a fight for our lives against pure evil. And these people, while they individually, some of them are, you know, just that pure evil, collectively, a lot of them don't even understand how they're being driven, just like we as a country. We were being rah, rah, rah up, and we, you know, chimed in because all our neighbors were chiming in because it was what you did. But all of a sudden, now, Doug, do you agree with that today? No, you've changed your mind. You've understood that maybe there wasn't, that wasn't what you thought it was at the time. And a lot of these people would be in the same boat if we had time to explain stuff and educate them. But it's like a dog with rabies. If you go out into the street and there's a dog with rabies and it's foaming at the mouth and it's, you know, Cujo and it's all killer dog, and you go, nice puppy, oh, you're sick, oh, I'm going to help you. That guy could kill you. One bite, it could infect you. It could kill your children. It could kill your family. It could make them seriously ill. It's not that the dog was evil by itself, but something horrible happened, and it now is dangerous. This is what we're really dealing with a lot of what's coming our direction, because we are dealing with people that have mentally been dialed up. They're infected in a certain way mentally, and we're going to have to face that. And
I've heard that told to me by the Border Patrol agents who encounter these MS-13. He said they're told to process them as anybody else, but he said, we'll ask them about their background and what they did, and they admit to torture and murder like it's just going to get a pack of gum at the convenience store.
Yeah, because that's part of the problem. See, you have people, you know, when you have somebody that's been, I had a friend who was in a South American country, another name that, you know, a lot of your audience would know, and some gang members thought that they probably had gold in their house, because he was in part owned operations of gold mine, a very large operation. So they came in, there was like 20 of them, took control of his household, where they had about a half a dozen people. And they're searching the place for all the gold, and they're going to rape the women, they're going to do all sorts of horrible things to the guys so they get the gold. And the guy's like, we don't have gold here in the house. We own stocks and shares in the mines. But those people, they had no clue. They didn't even think that way. They just know that these are gold people. And they couldn't, you couldn't talk to them. It wasn't until they promised them that they would go to the bank and get a bunch of money out while they held the rest of the family hostage that they were able to, you know, get a situation where they got out of it. And it fortunately worked out. But it was, they fortunately had time to educate these people to a level and work a deal. You know, when people are desperate and they think a certain way, you think you're going to have a logical conversation. A lot of these people, they're not stupid, but they're not smart either. They're a different kind of smart. And you're trying to have a conversation, an IQ 130 conversation with a person that, because they're sniffing paint and they're chewing on coca leaves, during their developmental years, they're, you know, at a 95 IQ. And they just don't have the mental tools. If you're going to try and have a logical conversation with them, I'm not saying, you know, I feel as a Christian, as a human being, horrible for these people, but they are being used as a tool by others who have a whole different plan, and they just happen to be using these people as their agents of opportunity to accomplish other things that they want to do. These poor people, they don't even realize how they're being used.
Dave, if I can interject here, Dave, you've done a lot of research on this. Do you have any questions for W about your research, your findings? This is your bailiwick, so I want to give you the opportunity to ask W anything, because it's about the very topic you're talking about right now.
Well, I pretty much have been with regard to these the cartel activities coming out of Peru. W, one of the things that I was told, too, is that it's the Peruvian military that's absolutely controlling this. Do you know about that?
Yeah, my history there is quite a bit further back, but, you know, it's kind of classic that in all of these locations that, you know, just like with Mexico, you have a good side of the military and a bad side of the military. It doesn't matter if you've been going to Italy with the police and the military there, you know, anywhere in the world you go, you got, you know, even in our own country, you got a good side of, you know, what I call the front office CIA, and you got a back office CIA. So that would, you know, wherever the guns and the money are, you know, political or corrupt, you know, you're going to have people in there that are good or bad guys. I don't have current knowledge there. And I think that Doug had a couple of contacts that had better stuff. I can give you some names that off there that would be great guys.
Yeah, I definitely want to get that
conversation.
The other thing that I've come across in my own research, and I've gotten some validation from this DEA source and one from someone who was formerly in the FBI. I made this statement to both of them. I said, where you find drug running today in the world to raise money to support gun running for regime change and use tariffs, you're also now finding child sex trafficking, and it's even more profitable than that. What do you know about that?
Well, I heard you talking about it, and I, you know, maybe off air we should talk on that separately. That you know, there's a real aspect to that, but it's probably not stuff I want to talk about on air for the time being. And there's, you know, for reasons that you'll understand when I talk to you off air.
Okay.
But,
well,
I'll throw out
publicly what I know is going on just in this country, and what I'm covering this case. The Monica Wesolowski case, trying to get her kid back from Virginia CPS. She's a State Department employee with a security clearance, and I think she was politically targeted. And without going into the details of the case, as this got popular starting in early May, I've been approached by so many whistleblowers. Two of them are ex-Virginia CPS workers, and what I've learned from them, as well as one in Texas, is that there are corporations and institutions like the CIA or elements of the CIA that are fronting foster parents going into a location, and when they procure enough kids through the foster arrangement, they just disappear with the kids. Now, the confirmation I've got from this on the CPS agents is that they pay these foster parents to watch these kids, and as a consequence, when they're not there any longer, you know, the checks bounce back. And I said, well, surely you go to the FBI and report them as missing or kidnapped or something. And they go, no, we effect one or two attempts at payment again, and then we just move on. And what I've been told also is that one person said they had knowledge, and I know Nancy Schaefer talked about this before she died, is that these people just pick up, move to a different state, and they're paid to get more kids, and these kids are just disappeared into sex trafficking operations.
Yeah, I will say this, a lot of what's coming on us as a country, I feel personally, is because we have allowed this to go on under our noses and with our money, cash, payola, our tax money, with the evil, the corruption that's been occurring with the kids in our society through the Child Protective Services, et cetera. And, you know, you have to remember that to the 90th percentile, maybe higher, the people in there are great people trying to do very, very difficult work and to help kids. They get into it because they want to make a difference. They want to help. But there's a certain element that, just like the guy that we'll be talking about on Monday, he looks at this as easy pickings. And they're not just one guy. They work in clusters. And so they will protect each other, getting into positions of authority inside these agencies, and then they'll work their own little cell, like a captured operation, to funnel kids through their groups and people to do what they want to do. And some of what we'll talk about privately, I think we'll explain some of that. But the reality is, you mentioned Vancouver, B.C. All you got to do is go down a little bit there to Washington State, and the whole nation knows about a lot of what was going on there in Washington State during the mid-90s. And it was unbelievably horrendous. And especially out of those counties there around Seattle, north and south of Seattle, with the trafficking of kids. You know, there was one house there, the Peggy Jeffries house, where they had literally hundreds and hundreds of kids going through the house a year. And there was an emergency, you know, placement home for kids that were picked up and they put them there for a day or two or five or whatever. And they'd have 20, 30 kids in a four-bedroom house every night, allegedly, with one adult present. And in the reports that were got by FOIA, by one of the moms who had a daughter that was there, a home kid, the home in a one-year period, they showed all the kids that came and went from the home in a one-year period. It was hundreds and hundreds. But in there, they had, as I recall, several dozen, not just one or two, but several dozen children under a year old. And on the reports, it said runaway. Not mother and daughter runaway. You wouldn't find a mother there. Just a six-month-old kid runaway. Three-month-old kid runaway.
Yeah.
What? What? And there were children there that were being picked up by according to some of the kids who were there present. And this was reported on Mike Reagan's radio talk show back at the time there in the 90s. So we're not talking something that's just a BS allegation. Mike Reagan had guests on who spoke directly to this, that they were escorting kids to satanic coven meetings. And these are teenagers from that house. Pick them up and bring them back later in the evening. And that's in some of the case records, et cetera, that were in some of these cases. I mean, just horrible. So this is all over the country. It's not just in one place. And these clusters, you know, they're going where the opportunities are. And I assume if it was going on then and it wasn't stopped then, which I don't think it ever was fully stopped, it's guaranteed still going on now, probably way worse.
Well, in the Oklahoman last year, they ran a story, and it was very, very incomplete story. And it said that 80 kids had disappeared from their CPS control in a one-week period. And I'm thinking, okay, where's the follow-up on this? So I took it upon myself to call, you know, the agency. And I said, excuse me, I'm making a legitimate inquiry here as to where your kids are. I mean, wasn't someone watching them when they didn't show up for roll call or they didn't show up for dinner? They're not going to school. I said, how do you lose 80? They wouldn't even talk to me. They would not give me anything of value, and yet we let these people get away with it. 80 kids go missing from an official state agency, and oh, well, so what?
Well, and again, part of the deal is they're protected by all the privacy laws and stuff like that, which they'll use to their advantage when it allows them to skate free, but flip the tables over, and if it's your kid and there's the slightest thing, they're right there to, you know, take you out whatever way they feel like. You know, and of course it's all based on these federal mandates and federal money and matching money that directs how the programs are operated. Most of the stuff that you see that's going wrong is somewhere related to federal money. For example, in the cases that you're dealing with, I believe that you're going to find, if you probably haven't already, that in most of the cases, kids are somewhere determined to have some kind of a special need. Oftentimes it's they're supposedly coming out homosexuals, and so they're special needs kids because they need special counseling and care and protection as they do that, or there'll be medical issue of some type that makes them a special need. Well, then they get a tremendous amount more federal money. And then there's also these various trusts that are out there. For example, kids whose mothers were exposed to chemicals and were born premature. There's Webley money out there from the Webley Trust. There's other things like that out there. And so these agencies will then, the attorneys will then go out and tap those funds in order to support these kids. Well, what is it really? It's a jobs program for state workers. It's a jobs program for these state agencies to increase their footprint and increase their numbers. And they get all this matching revenue, et cetera. And the more kids you have, the more money you get. And it's not about managing and helping the kids as much as it is about getting more and more revenue from whatever source. And, you know, then, you know, passing the kids around to your friends, you know, get a sex toy and get paid for it. So,
yeah, but, you know, it's really dangerous to look into this, too, and I want to point that out to people. I've had my own run-in where I was writing about this, and people started to surveil my family and let me know the information they had on them, and that caused me to do a strategic withdrawal for a few days. And then you look at, a lot of people don't know this, that with the Sandusky case, this is absolutely unbelievable that this wasn't made really public. But before Sandusky got busted, about 7 or 8 years before, the county attorney of Center County, which is where that area is located, was receiving information about Second Mile Foundation and Sandusky trafficking in kids, abusing kids, and so forth. And it got so bad that the county attorney there, Ray Greicard, decided, okay, this is going to be a political hot issue for me if I don't jump into it. So he jumped into it. And care to know what happened to Ray Greicard? They never found his body. The FBI found his computer in a creek and said it was too damaged to pull any information off of it. And then you got the murder of Nancy Schaefer. They called it a murder-suicide. Yeah, right, the husband shot himself in the back and then murdered her. So yeah, that's her scenario. This stuff is dangerous stuff. That tells me this is an extremely powerful group that's involved in this, and I think it's centralized at some level. You have the Franklin scandal with Lawrence King, and you know who they brought to clean that up was Herman Cain, who was the head of the Kansas City Federal Reserve at the time, Godfather Pizza owner and presidential candidate till his infidelities derailed his candidacy. So this is what we're dealing with in this arena.
Well, and again, I go back to the case that Doug's going to be talking about on Monday. In this particular case, the gentleman was a Satanist and working with other Satanists, and they would have their meetings, and, of course, including with other people, you know, hiding in plain sight. This goes back to the Tom Cruise movie with Eyes Wide Open. You have societies that are working in plain sight, and they're really coven satanic. And the guy on Monday, here's a guy that he wrote a book about how he became a Christian, and he's all turned around, and he's all better. In the meantime, while he's going to all these Rotary Club meetings, and he's the best guy, and he's smiling and shaking hands, he's planning his next murder there in the community and picking out his next victim. And so, and this is something where, as Christians, we have to not be so gullible right now. It's a trust but verify type thing. And we need to realize that there's a lot of wolves in sheep's clothing in government and other places. And that's why it's so important to have the rule of law being enforced and not just, the, oh, yeah, we'll sort it out. And I go back into the simplest things. Is the guy a citizen? Has he got paperwork? Okay. Is the voting actually legitimate voting, or is it a diebold? Because these people get themselves in a position of authority and power, and then how do you get them out? And you're just going to be trusting because, well, nobody would rig the vote. You know, nobody would agree to let somebody in there that's not actually, you know, a fellow citizen, you know, things like that. And that's how things come unraveled. And next thing you know, look the other way on the little thing here because, well, he's going to get us more mortgage money or higher mortgage stuff. Look the other way a little over there because they bring more jobs into our states because they get this little contract, and so they're doing a little something on the side. Next thing you know, corruption's everywhere, and you've lost your community to the mob. And really, our country's come, you know, we're being run by the mob. You know, it's the Chicago mob versus the New York mob.
The government is the mob.
Yeah.
They might wear suits and pledge allegiance to the flag, but they're the mafia. Let me tell you what I mean. There's a 58-page report by this DEA special agent. He gave it to ISA and Gowdy and three others, and initially staffers showed interest from all parties. And then when they start seeing the money laundering and the banks involved, we're talking B of A, J.P. Morgan Chase, HSBC. When this was revealed in his 58-page report about trafficking out of Peru, they didn't want to talk to him. Okay, well, if you're elected to represent us and you're not willing to take the report of an active special agent of the DEA saying there's corruption, then you're complicit in the corruption. That makes you a member of the mafia.
Mm-hmm. Well, again, you know, sins of commission, sins of omission. The reason that we're in trouble at so many levels is that we have allowed so much to get by us as citizens because, in part, we are so busy just trying to pay the bills and keep the mortgage paid and do the work. And so both the husband and the wife are working. And, you know, when I was growing up, you were growing up, there was moms home in every house on the street when you came home from school. And if your mom wasn't home, one of the other moms was home and knew exactly what was going on with all the kids in the neighborhood. And but as we've gotten more and more to where, you know, everybody's busy doing something, you know, racing to and fro just to pay the taxes and just to keep food on the table and keep the mortgage paid, there's less and less ability, time, to go out and go to the PTA meeting, to go to the city council meeting, and to actually pay attention to what's actually going on. We've entrusted other people, and these other people haven't always been trustworthy, or they're good people, but they get in there, and next thing you know, in order to get along, go along, keep the ball moving, and sort it out, they agree to things that they might not otherwise accept. Well, it's going to bring this in or that, and they're enticed into an agreement. And next thing you know, it's not working the way we plan because government's doing everything. It's you know, going a direction that is not healthy. We're a captured operation at this point in time, so captured that I don't know that we can reel it in time. And now this, you know, infection is going, you know, viral in such a way that, you know, it could take us out. I had a very good friend years and years ago who got a strep infection and it damaged her heart muscle and at 33 years old died of heart failure. And yet was healthy all the way until got this strep infection. We could be relatively healthy. We get this infection of these people that don't think like us getting too spread out through the country and who have a different plan, and they take out some of the key ways we work and interact and disable them intentionally or unintentionally. Just by weighing it down when we're already in a weakened condition on so many fronts societally. And next thing you know, it could be fatal to us as a country. And I think that that's what we are collectively feeling in this type of an audience, that we are in serious imminent danger. It's not that it couldn't be turned around, and it's not that it's you know, if we were healthy as a country, if we were healthy as a people, we could fight off the infection. We could overcome it. We've done it lots of times before. But there's a certain point where your immunity level and your nutrition level and other things have dropped to some critical low. And then if you don't treat it quickly enough, just like with her strep infection, she didn't realize she had a strep infection. She just thought she had a bad cold. And it was something different than what she thought it was. Everybody's had a cold. She had a cold. She had a sore throat. But then suddenly she realized too late that it was far more serious than she understood because she misdiagnosed the symptoms. And once they found out, the damage was so extreme, and then she was not quite strong enough in the rest of her corporal body to sustain and to make it through that. And that's where I'm saying right now we as a country are in an exceptionally weakened state. The only other thing I'd add, though, is that George Washington talks about this third conflict that he saw for the country, like the second, which was the Civil War, another Civil War. But at the end of it, all the great cities in flames, no one left save the countryside dwellers. And I think that that's what, you know, your FEMA friend and others are talking about, that, you know, when society comes unraveled, the hardest place to be is in the cities. And that's the story of the Mayans. I was down in the Mayan ruins years ago, and we went to a pyramid that had only been discovered by satellite. We were some of the very first people there within weeks of finding it in these satellite images, you know, still out under the undergrowth. And some of the local Mayans who had learned to speak English in order to talk with us tourists, they learned it only in a matter of months. It was amazing. So they were not read into so much that we are in Western culture. So I had very, what I thought, uncorrupted conversations. And one of the things, you know, why did the Mayans disappear? They said, well, they didn't appear. We are the Mayans. But there was a time in their history when there was a great famine, a great drought that caused the famine in the cities. And so the people just agreed to move and spread out into the jungle, away from the cities, because they just couldn't all live in one place. And that's how they survived. They just spread out, and they abandoned their cities. And at some level, unfortunately, if we are unable to sustain living in this highly collective environment, which requires that we be able to work together, that there be utilities, that there be sewer systems, that there be traffic lights, that there be trucks that can bring the food in and pick up the waste out of the city. If, you know, think of New York back when the power went out in the 60s, and, you know, or a garbage strike or something like that. If that collective infrastructure fails for whatever reason, an EMP, a virus where you don't trust to go out and interact with people, the trucks don't run from the grocery store, the threats from gang members or all of the above, terrorist acts, all of a sudden, we as a people cannot function in this highly collected, centralized structure that we have here in our country. What makes America, America, this business-type arrangement, ceases to happen, and the only way to survive is to spread out.
Gentlemen, let me just jump in here, because I've got about a half a dozen emails just in the last 15 minutes and probably 40 more before that throughout the day. This is a question for both of you, if you don't mind answering this. Dave Hodges first. This from Helen, as well as I said, probably four dozen others, but this from Helen, first to Dave Hodges, then to W. Jim Garrow came out on Facebook today and said there would be some sort of, based on his information, there would be some sort of terrorist attack on a mall, planned explosive devices targeting shopping malls that will happen across America at numerous locations. First, Dave Hodges, your thoughts on that? And then,
well, I think Jim Garrow is entirely in the right arena. I do expect to see these kinds of things happen. They're agitation events leading up to the big false flag. They're not the false flag. And I'll tell you what I have said in the past, and it's a horrible thing to say it, but it's a worse thing not to say it so we don't force our leaders to prepare for it. But if I wanted maximum effect of terrorism, what I would do is I'd back up vans with 50 caliber machine guns at the dismissal time for elementary schools and hit 10 of them in one day. See how much attention you get that way. That'd be more horrific than doing the malls, but I think Jim is probably right. There's probably something in the planning. But the one of the things, and I've never been an intelligence operative, but I'll speak about the ones I know and what they tell me. They say there's a multitude of operations planned when they want to carry out some kind of objective. They might have five plans and two contingency plans off of each plan, and so they become crimes of opportunity. So if something may not work on Monday because of the way the wind's blowing, but Tuesday it would have worked pretty well. And so it just depends on your circumstances on which one of these you roll out.
Yeah, it's the only thing that I would have said is just, you know, it's whatever opportunity presents itself. The problem is we've made ourselves vulnerable on so many fronts that, you know, it could be anything. And, you know, which specific ways we get undermined, you know, at some level, it's which mob group strikes first, because we got several of them coming. You know, we are exposed on so many fronts. And so how do we get ourselves back on track as a society and begin to work the problem? You know, if you're a test pilot and something's not going right inside your aircraft, you don't start flailing your arms around and crying and whatever. That's, you know, otherwise you would never have got to that position. You start to work the problem. You try to diagnose it, and then you prioritize. Same thing in the emergency room with triage. You prioritize the things that will end the life and make everything else irrelevant. And you work the biggest problems first, and you stabilize what you can, and you start to work the problem. And what I'm concerned about is while we have lots of listeners that are listening, paying attention, thinking about these things, the things that should be being done at the government level, whether it be hardening our facilities for an EMP, hardening societally for an EMP, or cutting off the pathways where an Ebola or other outbreak could get a foothold here in the country, or the terrorist virus, gang virus coming up from South America. All of those can and should be addressed. And if our immune system was working properly, we would be doing what we've done for 250 years. Address the problem, work the problem. But at this point, all of the things that should be being done aren't being done, and all of the things that shouldn't be being done are being done. It's completely topsy-turvy. And then you have to ask, and so who benefits? We're a crime scene. Who benefits? Why are we a crime scene? Somebody has designs on us. It's like you go by the mob restaurant, and there's guys hanging stuff from the ceiling, and you're going, well, they're decorating it. No, those are the freaking wax pieces that they're going to burn the thing down with. Everything in here, you know, it's stuff to burn the building down, it seems like. And that's a problem. And we have to realize what's afoot and start taking action or get out of the way. You got one or the other. You got to do something.
I'm going to tell you, Dave, you've been at the forefront of all of this, and your articles are very insightful. And I got to tell you, I really appreciate what you're doing. Any last comments for W here as we're kind of really unbelievably coming to the close of our
program? Well, let me just say, Dave, I apologize. I didn't plan to spend this long. I apologize.
Well, I think there's no apology needed because I think you've added greatly to what we were discussing, and I appreciate you coming on and spending the amount of time you did.
Yeah, to you both, let me tell you. Somebody sent me an email saying, hey, why are you guys so quiet? Well, you know, when two intellectuals are discussing, it's good to know when to keep your mouth shut. And I got to tell you, that's flat out. I learned a lot of listening, you know, and I hope, I know our audience did too. Closing comments for you both. I mean, W, we'll cut you loose first. Your closing comments.
Well, I mean, I think I said everything I need to say, and your listeners know that, you know, I pop in and out from time to time. My main concern is that if we're looking for leaders to come out of the woodwork to save the day, some Superman politician or person to save the day, the one thing I think we have to remember, you know, for example, Trey Gowdy, you know, he's a real firebrand, and he's made it clear that he wants to go after all these people. But you know what the problem is? He's got to work inside of a system where even the people that are put in there to help him, to weed out, to figure out what they're going to do and how they're going to ask the questions and who they're going to ask the questions of, a lot of that is screened and done for him and offered to him. And so what happens is that he may or may not be fully aware of it, even when he is aware that the screening is taking place. It's within certain limits. There's some reason why the system, whether it be Bonner and other people, have agreed to let him do what he's going to do, because he's going to stay within certain parameters. So if you think you're going to get to the whole truth, you might get to a truth. And the question is, how far into that truth are we going to get? So we talk about, you know, Benghazi. Well, if you don't get to Syria, you didn't get to Benghazi. If you don't get to what was really at the heart of everything that was going on in that region, and the fact that somebody wanted us in a major conflict out of Syria, then you didn't get to the core of Benghazi. You might have got a security issue, you might have got somebody that dropped their guard, you might have got a little money that should have been spent here, and some money didn't get spent there. You don't get to Syria, you didn't get anything. That's the way it is. The fix it is. And he can be absolutely righteous in what he's trying to do, but he's in the system. You know, this Mr. Deeds goes to Washington and sets everything right. Look, you got one honest guy trying hard, and every lobbyist, all the money, all the aides and assistants and the people that are offered to help, and they all got an angle, and that angle, little bit here, little bit there, well, just don't go to this one thing here because that would interrupt what we got going over at this other place. Next thing you know, you're not actually getting to the core truth. It's so filtered. It's so dampened down. And all of a sudden, the system continues on just like it's been going all along further down this slippery slope into the disaster ahead. And you could name any subject that Dave and I have discussed tonight, and it's a similar thing. I remember on the drug flights coming in from South America back in the 90s, and the DEA agents and the IRS agents had every tail number, all the names of the people involved, where they were landing, who was getting the drugs. Incredible case that they put together. So the Senate's going to get to the bottom of all of this corruption happening in these southern states and the stuff coming up out of South America related to Iran-Contra and way before Clinton got in office. And so the Senate sends out the Banking Committee and the Intelligence Oversight Committee. Both require all the hard copy documentation from all the agencies and agents involved so they can do their investigation. They want all the original documents. Well, you know, David, if you're going to go into court, you know, Doug, you need your original notes, your original evidence with your initials on it in order to testify and have your testimony be accepted. The Senate got all of the original hard copy stuff. These guys were required to box it up and under guard send it off and it's secured away. Well, where did it all go? It went right next to the Ark of the Covenant in the Indiana Jones warehouse. Did anybody ever go to jail? Did anybody ever, you know, the only guys that got dealt with were off, like Barry Seal. The crimes got addressed because people got off, like what you were talking about with these other folks, Dave, and that's the problem, because they allege they're going to go stop the crimes and get the bad people, and they get all the evidence, and then it suddenly stops. It goes into a black hole, and that's our situation right now. It's like, you know, simple question, where's the birth certificate? The real one. And you can't get to that. So if you can't get that, what about the illegal voting? We're about to have another election. You think you're going to trust the outcome of this coming election? Really? Did they stop using Diebold voting machines? Give me a break. You're a captured operation.
Amen.
You should be fearing for your family's well-being, your nation's well-being, and it's not going to get fixed because one politician comes to the rescue, because there is no one politician that can come to the rescue. If he shows his head, if he pops up, the nail that pops up gets hammered down. That's the problem. And the people coming to the rescue, you'll have 8 or 10 guys that are absolutely good guys, and their credibility will be used by 2 or 3 that are in there to manage the problem and identify anybody that's trying to take it off subject or go someplace else, and then they'll marginalize them and take them out and find a way to do it so that the investigation won't go these other places. And the other guys, their credibility is there at the table, and they're like, well, they must know what they're talking about. And I can tell you right now that it's scary if you, when they don't know even some of the most basic aspects, and they're going to run the country and things that are core things to how our country evolved. A lot of your listeners know more about what's happened to get our country to where we're at right now than people supposedly that are in places in the know. They're in Washington, D.C. that have got the high-paying jobs and been there forever because they know everything in a very protected way within their circle. They only talk a certain way because that's the way they all know and agree to talk. That's the way it is. They do the secret handshake and everybody agrees not to go to these other places. Anyway.
Amen. All right, brother.
I apologize for being so dominant on time, I just wanted to add that one little thing that obviously rang out, but thanks for letting me get in there.
It's been my honor to be on with you.
W, God bless you, my friend. Thank you, sir.
Dave,
take us out. Close us down. Tell us what's on your mind here. We've got about, we've got about 10 minutes here. And you know what? I want to thank you for being such an honorable guy, a guy of integrity and character. And thank you for your articles. And folks, if you haven't read them, thecommonsenseshow.com. Having said that, wrap this up and where are we at here? I mean,
well, thank you, Doug. And I think that the first place I would start with is the cornerstone of our existence, and that's get your spiritual house in order. Even at some levels of the NSA, and I've learned from friends of mine from the late A.C. Griffith to Vance Davis, they teach this as a battle between good and evil, and they're speaking on a spiritual sense. And so this means that someone in that house that you live in needs to become the spiritual leader of that house and get everybody on board with what the true truths are in our world. The second thing I would say is some of us will survive what's coming. I mean, I do think there's a cataclysm of sorts coming. Maybe it won't be an EMP. Right now, that would be my vote. But you need to do the normal prepping things, and that doesn't guarantee survival. It's like exercising and eating healthy. You might live long, you might not, but give it a shot. The third thing is more of a daily, have a family emergency plan kind of action. And let me tell you what's going on in the schools here in Arizona, and then lo and behold, I found it out it was going on all over the country. Last year, the Arizona Department of Education distributed to all its public schools and institutions, universities, community colleges, a questionnaire for each employee to fill out. And the employee was supposed to acknowledge what their skills were. Now, some of these things, in the event of an emergency, you'd want people to have. These were legitimate questions, such as, can you do EMP, or EMP, can you do emergency services, medical services? Have you been a nurse? Do you know how first aid? Do you know how to do a triage of a casualty situation? Can you repair an electric circuit? Because if you were stuck at a place for a few hours or a day or two or three, these would be good services. Then they got into some stuff, Doug, that was just frightening. Stuff like, do you know how to handle these advanced construction materials? And they would just spell out what they were. And some of this stuff, I'm not in the construction industry, but my brother-in-law is. And I went to him and I said, Joe, what's going on here with it? He goes, they're looking at building buildings with barbed wire and fencing. And this is a document, and I found out that it actually came out of DHS initially. It's about building your own FEMA camp on a school campus. I kid you not.
Man.
In fact, I went and I compared what they were asking to what was in that 2011 secret memo from KBR that I alluded to earlier in the show, and it was a pretty close match. So the schools are doing what the government tells them. Most of the school employees are headed by great administrators, good and caring school board members, and the teachers, most of the time, are pretty darn good. But they follow the edicts of the government like good little sheep, and they don't question anything they're told to do. They do these bus evacuation drills, and they did them in all kinds of past drills involving NFL stadiums. They're going to be the new FEMA camps as well. A lot of people don't know this, but the NFL, Major League Baseball, the National Basketball Association, National Hockey League, and Simon Properties, that's the biggest owner of malls in North America, have signed an agreement with DHS to use these as containment or detainment facilities in times of national emergency. And at schools, what they're doing now all over is they do these bus evacuation drills. And I have my son in a top rate school, and I do it with some hesitation because I'm hoping that we'll get him through school before the proverbial poop hits the fan. But if things really start to go south, I'm going to pull him out and we'll homeschool him. But right now, he's under orders from his dad. You do not get on a school bus unless you're going for, like, your cross-country meet or to play golf or something. You don't get on these buses, ever. He goes, what do I do? I said, you hide the bathroom and call me and I'll come get you.
I love this.
And I told him, I said, I don't care if it's your favorite teacher giving you an order. In that situation, my word is stronger than your teacher. And I've got him convinced to that point. And you parents need to do the same thing. Because what they did in Denver, and what was that, Operation Mountain Guardian in 2011, when they shut down DIA, and they used Invesco Field where the Broncos play as a housing center, they went unannounced to Denver Public Schools, and FEMA grabbed kids and put them on buses and then took them to the stadium. They hired mock parent volunteers to desensitize the workers, the guards, into not releasing the kids. Well, by the end of the day, when Johnny wasn't there to be picked up, when Mama showed up for his noon dental appointment and the parents got wind of what was going on, they had real parents there screaming at them. But this is what they'll do to your kids. And I'll tell you, the thinking I have is they get your kids in a FEMA camp, how long will it be till they entice you there?
In about 5 seconds, so. I mean, think about it, Dave.
It's an evil genius tactic.
Yeah.
I mean, what better way than to use children as bait to lure their parents, you know?
The NFL stadiums, and I boycott NFL football now, and I grew up playing football in high school and loved the sport and liked to watch it, but the NFL... I'll give you an example of how bad they've become. At Arrowhead Stadium, and I've got a picture of this as an article I wrote about, if you Google NFL are going to be the new FEMA camps, words of that effect, you'll go and you'll see the pictures. At Arrowhead Stadium, they actually separated men and women going into the games for security purposes, and starting last year they had TSA-type shakedowns where they can grope you, you walk through the metal detector. In fact, actually in the article what I did is I put a TSA examiner in one box and the next box over to visually illustrate the similarity. I showed what they were doing at the NFL stadiums. They're conditioning people to go into FEMA camps. They will separate men from women and children from their parents. And that's a foregone conclusion. And they're conditioning this right now on entry into some of the NFL stadiums, not all of them. They don't do it here in Arizona, because I checked and saw where the Cardinals play at University of Phoenix Stadium. They don't do that, but they are doing it in Kansas City. And they did the same drill that they did in Denver in Giant Stadium. And you want to have chills go up and down your spine? I got a YouTube recording I put in an article, and you can hear the FEMA workers saying, okay, well, we'll just take the kids over to the red zone. Now, if you walk into a football stadium, you're going to hear the term red zone, because that's a term that means that your offensive team has the ball inside the 20-yard line and they're ready to score. Red zone offense. Okay, that's not what they were talking about. Red zone. Take the kids to the red zone. Let's hearken to Steve Quayle. Red list, blue list. If that's not frightening, I don't know what is.
Yeah.
So, parents, my point is, long-winded point, you need to educate your kids that you don't need to give them all the politics and the geopolitics and the things we're talking about here, but you need to let them know there's a time to disrespect authority. And getting on school buses and going to stadiums is a no-no. And I don't think kids should have cell phones, but in this day and age, for safety and to communicate with parents and stuff. Now, the other thing, too, what if the EMP does come? What if it does come to your community and they attack us on a regional basis and you're unlucky enough to be in a regional area? You need to have a predetermined meeting place with your family, somewhere where you can walk or bike to. You need to get the family together, because you don't, in those first few critical hours, and all the research studies on this, and this is something I go back to as my days as a former undergraduate sociology instructor, is I used to do these scenarios where we'd have the breakdown of society and measure what level would society sink to. And all the studies say the same thing. If you're looking for reunification of families, it happens in the first few hours. Usually it's in the first 30 minutes, or it doesn't happen until the crisis is over. So you need to have a reunification plan if you want to survive as a family unit. And if an EMP attack comes, you're really going to be tested. because if you work 25 miles away from your house, you better have some stuff in your car that's going to sustain you and a way to protect it. Read between the lines.
Indeed, read between the lines and read the lines of Mr. Dave Hodges. The Common Sense Show is his website, The Common Sense Show. Dave, you're heard, what, every Sunday night?
Every Sunday night from 9 p.m. to midnight Central, and I think we're lucky enough to get the best of guests. I mean, I've been fortunate enough to have you on, and I got to twist Joe's arm here. Joe, I'm going to be calling you soon. I want to get you on the show as well. But we have terrific guests, and we talk about a lot of the same things you are here. One is just how to get through this crazy world, survive and love God and love your family and try to enjoy your life, but stay safe at the same time.
You know what, my brother, I think now it's so important for all of us, especially those that are fortunate enough to have the talk show venue, to stick together, to support one another, to be a part of the solution and to inform other people. And I think that's exactly what you're doing.
Hopefully, thank you. Well, that's why I relish appearing with W tonight. He apologized for taking away my time. He didn't take away my time. He educated the audience tonight, and that's why we're here.
Indeed. That'll do it, folks. Dave, thank you so very much. God
my pleasure,
bless you.
Guys.
Please
anytime.
Stay safe. All right. Good night, everyone. Folks, that'll do
thanks,
it.
Dave.
Until tomorrow. Have a good night.